Okay, good morning, everyone. Welcome to our symposium. I guess the first thing I should say that for the guys here is that this is also being broadcast on the internet. So be careful what you say. We've got I have to credit Juan Carlos Sanchez at the back here, because it was really his idea to link this symposium with a workshop and to give a bit of space for guys, those crazy folk who are really interested in international water law, a bit of space to share some ideas, some new issues, some emerging issues around the development and implementation of international water law. So I'm really delighted that we had a very great response to our calls and invitations, and as you can see, a really nice lineup of speakers through the day. It's going to be a fun-filled day. I've asked Zaki Schubert here from UNESCO IHE to chair the first session. For those of you who don't know me, I should say my name is Dr. Alistair Reed Clark. I'm a reader in international law here at the Centre for Water Law Policy Science at the University of Dundee. So I think, given the interest of time, I'll cross over to Zaki to chair the first session.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you, Alistair, for the introduction. I'm delighted to be chairing the session this morning. We've got, six speakers this morning, and we'll have three presentations, a break, and then another three presentations. Each presentation will be about 20 minutes, and then hopefully we'll have 10 minutes for discussion. And I think, in the interest of time, we should kick off. So I'm delighted to be welcoming Dr. Owen McIntyre from the University of Cork, who will be talking to us about legal interpretation in the context of sharing the benefits of ecosystem services within transboundary waters. So Owen, please, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Zaki. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Zaki. What I want to talk about this morning is really about benefit sharing and about the possible role of benefit sharing, this paradigm or this sort of approach or device of benefit sharing in ecological protection of transboundary rivers. And I want to look at this for a very particular reason, that benefit sharing, to the extent that we've seen benefit sharing actually work, in a limited number of examples of working benefit sharing arrangements, that it is usually operated to promote infrastructural development. It's usually operated for hydropower development, for example, is the key example. So very often it works to facilitate large infrastructure development, which itself, of course, has often quite serious ecological implications, adverse ecological implications. But I want to sort of turn that around, and I want to suggest that benefit sharing might function very, very well as a means of protecting transboundary watercourse ecosystems. And I have become interested in this really through some work I did last summer in China, working at the China International Water Law Program, or with the China International Water Law Program in Xiamen, Professor Wooders. And this is an approach that Chinese policymakers are considering in terms of their hydro diplomacy with their southern neighbors in particular, with whom they don't yet have much in the way of formal agreements or arrangements. So I want to start off with a statement or an assertion, and it is that we appear, when we look at international water law today, the state of international water law, we appear to have a good deal of convergence around the core principles, the core requirements of international water law. there's been a degree of convergence around the basic requirements here. So if we go back to the 66 Helsinki rules, the sort of origins of a modern codified body of rules of international water law, right through the 92 UNECE Helsinki Convention, of course the UN Watercourses Convention as maybe a key statement of coastal international law. The 2008 International Law Commission draft articles on transboundary aquifers, other regional agreements, very significant regional agreements like the 2000 SADC Advice Protocol, and a whole slew of watercourse agreements, basin agreements. What we see is that we have convergence around three basic rules. And these are equitable and reasonable utilization. I don't think anyone would dispute that. The duty to prevent significant transboundary harm. And then the duty to cooperate, and particularly the procedural elements within the duty to cooperate, notification very importantly, but ongoing exchange of information, consultation and negotiation. So at a sort of at the level of values, what we're left with really is equity and environmental and ecological sustainability. These would appear to be the key kind of values that we have, because environmental and ecological sustainability are inherent to each of these. Inherent to equitable and reasonable utilization, inherent to the duty to prevent significant transboundary harm. The harm we're seeking to prevent is very often environmental and ecological. And of course, the duty to cooperate is very much about cooperating to prevent adverse social effects and economic effects, but increasingly environmental effects. If we think, for example, that I often think of when we think of the duty to cooperate and the procedural rules inherent in the duty to cooperate, transboundary environmental impact assessment is absolutely central. It's almost like a glue that holds all of these together. And it, of course, comes out of an environmental paradigm. So there appears to be really broad convergence around these three values. I don't think anyone would disagree with that. But actually, when we look at the practice of states in this field, there is actually a divergence. These principles and values are understood rather differently, particularly by upstream and downstream states. There seems to be a real dichotomy here in terms of how it's understood. If we look at the history of the development of the 97 UN Watercourses Convention, all the states that voted against in the UN General Assembly vote are upstream states, are significant upstream states, Burundi, China, and Turkey. But as well as that, a number of other very significant upstream states abstained in the General Assembly vote. Bolivia, Ethiopia, Mali, Tanzania, etc. Now, why was that? Well, it was because the duty to prevent significant transboundary harm that was included in Article 7 as a specific and express obligation alongside equitable and reasonable utilization, the upstream states were suspicious of its express inclusion, thinking that this would inevitably limit their development options. The upstream states' development options, that any development options which involve new uses and any kind of adverse impacts flowing downstream, this was likely to limit their options and to restrict their opportunities for development. But at the same time, in terms of reasonable and equitable and reasonable utilization, downstream states, we see, were suspicious of the subordination of the no harm rule to equitable and reasonable utilization. I think most of us understand that. That, you know, although that was a great sort of debate within the International Law Commission during the development of their draft rules, that the duty to prevent significant transboundary harm, we know it's not an absolute obligation. We know it's an obligation as to conduct rather than as to result, but we also know that it is to some extent, probably to a significant extent, subordinated to equitable and reasonable utilization. Now that ground has been gone over before. But downstream states were very suspicious of that. That the predominance of equitable and reasonable utilization as the key rule of international water law would give very significant scope for upstream states to develop at the cost of downstream states. And we see examples of states that expressed great concerns about this and abstained: Egypt, France, Pakistan, Peru, etc. So the appearance of convergence, the appearance of consensus, but actually when we dig into it, not so much agreement. And that dichotomy particularly appears to be between upstream and downstream states. So, you know, what is this based on? Well, you know, really a misunderstanding of international law or not, I would argue. First of all, you know, that we should understand equitable and reasonable utilization as being easily flexible enough to accommodate arrangements for the equitable sharing of downstream benefits. Equitable sharing across the entire basin of downstream benefits. And I'm thinking particularly here about the downstream benefits, economic or otherwise, of upstream ecological stewardship. We should also remember that the no harm rule may include harm to downstream states and foreclosure of upstream uses. And Salman has done a lot of work in this and has written very prominently in this in the last number of years. But essentially, downstream uses by becoming established uses. We know, for example, that within the framework of equitable and reasonable utilization, within, for example, the framework provided by the UN Watercourses Convention, that no category of use enjoys inherent priority over any other category of use. Isn't that right? And we've all gone over that ground. But actually, in reality, don't we know that it's going to be very, very difficult to displace an established use? If equitable and reasonable utilization is about dependence, you can establish and you can quantify dependence in terms of an existing use in a way that you can never do in terms of a potential future use. And Salman has sort of unpacked this and articulated this to say that what really happens when you get established downstream uses is that they foreclose on potential uses upstream. They make it extremely difficult to justify those uses in terms of equitable and reasonable balancing. So we should think of harm as flowing in both directions. We traditionally think of harm as flowing downstream, but we ought to think of harm as potentially flowing upstream as well. So what we actually need is a more sophisticated understanding of the key substantive and consequentially of the key procedural rules of international law. So towards reconciliation of these two positions, of these sort of the traditional upstream and downstream positions, and understandings of international law. What we have actually sort of unfolding, I think unfolding fairly rapidly when we consider the often glacial pace of developments in international law, what's unfolding very rapidly is an evolution of requirements of ecosystems protection. We're starting to understand a great deal more how ecological protection might be affected. I know that in my own mind, going back to first reading the Article 20 of the UN Watercourses Convention and seeing this obligation to protect the ecosystems of international watercourses, and it was all very laudable, very commendable, and very welcome, but I'm not sure any of us were all that clear how this would work, what it would involve. So, you know, we have the development of a host of methodologies, of ways of doing this. And they're only unfolding, but at least there's a real sort of movement behind them. So the so-called ecosystems approach, we're starting to understand now a little bit more about this sort of planning and management approach, this ecosystems approach, putting the ecosystem at the center of our concerns. And for example, the idea of environmental flows, the development of environmental flow methodologies, the recognition of a requirement to maintain and safeguard minimum environmental flows. I think Zaki was talking about this in the context of Kishanganga yesterday. And methodologies around environmental flows, I think things like integrated basin flow analysis. So, you know, to look at all of the uses dependent on certain quantity of flow. The whole notion of ecosystem services, which Alistair has done a bit on, and around payment for ecosystem services. So we're starting to see, you know, the ecology we no longer see ecosystems protection as being separate from the economic use of watercourses and of basins. So we look at all of the various benefits that we get, if we look at them in terms of ecosystem services, this gives us a sort of parameters, a structure, a framework. And then, of course, payment for these services in some form or other. Other issues that help us in terms of these understandings would be the water, energy, food nexus discourse. And again, that just helps us to understand, I think, the notion of ecosystem services. We look at, you know, essential uses that water can put to. So In this context, what I'd like to argue is that benefit sharing arrangements can be used to secure ecosystem services basin-wide, or to distribute the benefit of these ecosystem services basin-wide. So benefit sharing itself, this whole idea of benefit sharing, you know, what is it? Well, there's a number of different definitions. I quite like the definition Sadoff and Gray, and it's action designed to change the allocation of costs and benefits. And of course, benefits, costs and benefits here include economic, social, political, and of course, environmental. So action designed to change the allocation of costs and benefits requiring some form of redistribution or compensation. Okay? So involving what? Well, yeah, payments for benefits are compensation for costs regarding upstream stewardship of transboundary watercourses. Okay, so some sort of payment for or some sort of transfer of benefits, redistribution of benefits, having regard to this upstream stewardship. What do you get if you say forgo development upstream? If you choose to forgo that development so that, let's say if it is hydropower development, which has been the traditional issue upon which benefit sharing arrangements have developed, that the hydro plant might be located in the correct place, where it'd be most efficient, where it'd be most ecological or least ecologically harmful, but then some form of distribution of the benefits, compensation, distribution of energy, whatever. So, some sort of payment or compensation for these costs. And sort of the benefits of this upstream stewardship might involve interseasonal flows or storage, reduced flooding, sediment load management, ecosystem management, etc. So the advantages, the key advantages are that, you know, where the allocation of quantum share is inefficient. I would argue allocation of quantum share of water, the traditional paradigm, who gets how much water? Right, has been the traditional question of concern. I would argue that's always going to be inefficient. Always going to be inefficient. The idea that we just share out the water on the basis of what each state needs. But if you just even consider the state of development, the stage in their economic development of states on a transboundary water course, you know, how do you allocate water to one state to facilitate their ongoing development? They will very often not be in will not have the wherewithal to use any additional quantum share of water. So it's a very, very crude device, a very sort of one-dimensional and very crude device. So this is very often going to be inefficient, and benefit sharing allows us to take a much more sophisticated approach. So a basin-wide approach towards optimizing benefits. And if we look at the key agreements that we cited earlier, they nearly all talk about optimizing utilization, about optimizing benefits. You know, so really we should maybe think hard about what that's going to mean. A framework for the equitable sharing of costs and benefits, which I would argue falls very squarely within equitable and reasonable utilization. And it also facilitates broad issue linkage, both water and non-water related issues. So we can tie all of these things together and we can offset different benefits against different costs. As an example, even in terms of water-related uses, sort of water, energy, food, and exit again, which is an example of how we can begin to do that. If we look at lessons, what do we know about how this occurs? What do we know about what's required to make this work? Well, the first thing we know from the sort of the flagship example, the working example, which is always highlighted, which is always brought forward to show us how benefit sharing can work, the 1961 Columbia River Treaty. What we do know about that is that you need a very, very sophisticated institutional and legal framework to facilitate cooperation. I mean, I think the one thing that we've all heard at the workshop earlier this week in Germany is equitable and reasonable utilization, this cardinal principle. If you're actually going to have any chance of moving towards achieving any form of equitable and reasonable utilization, it's a complex business, isn't that correct? It's going to be a very, very, very complex business. You're going to need, you know, develop institutional structures. You're going to need capacity issue and all the rest of it. But if you move this out into broader issues, if you're talking about sharing benefits in relation to water-related benefits and non-water-related benefits, it becomes, you know, an order of magnitude more complex. So we will need sophisticated institutional and legal structures. There's a number of challenges, and I'm referring to work by Professor Pat Withers and Dan Tarlock. There's the problem of unequal bargaining power, you know, when you get into benefit sharing, but there's a problem of unequal bargaining power anyway, right? But yes, it's a concern. And related to unequal bargaining power, the predatory sale of future uses, where states desperate for some benefit today may give up future uses and place themselves at a long-term disadvantage for short-term gain. And again, that's always a risk. And there's an increased risk of aquatic ecosystem degradation. That has been the experience to date, because we've looked at benefit sharing as a means simply of developing infrastructure. Now, the legal basis, well, benefit sharing is not required. It doesn't appear to be required in any sense, but it's certainly permitted under international water law principles. If we look at equitable and reasonable utilization, if we take the UN Watercourses articulation of the principle, Article 5.1 of the Watercourses Convention talks about attaining optimal and sustainable utilization thereof of the watercourse and benefits therefrom, taking into account the interests of the watercourse. Yeah, it seems to certainly be broad enough to encompass benefit sharing. And Article 6 as well, remember, of the Watercourses Convention provides us with an open-ended list of factors. So we can put in any other factors we choose here. States may choose to include whatever is relevant to them. And if we think again of the articulation under the Helsinki rules, and we should never underestimate how important the Helsinki rules were. They, you know, as the first codification, gave rise to all subsequent developments in this area. It talks about a share of beneficial uses expressed legally. And talks also about the practicality of compensation to one or more states. So we can understand benefit sharing as one of two equitable and reasonable utilization models, wet water allocation being one, and we can combine that with, or that could be substituted by, benefit sharing. So this notion of the equitable apportionment of additional benefits of enhanced cooperation. Similarly, for the no harm rule, Article 7.2 of the Watercourses Convention talks about states taking account of all appropriate measures or engaging all appropriate measures and including questions of compensation. So compensation is envisaged. Harm, of course, includes adverse impact on a range of interests, including non-water interests. And as we said earlier, harm may travel upstream under this notion of foreclosure, articulated by someone. Damage to ecosystems is, of course, I don't think anyone would argue, is a key adverse impact. Article 20 of the Watercourses Convention makes that clear, requiring states to act jointly where necessary to protect ecosystems. And benefit sharing arrangements may very easily be one of those ways. How do you stop upstream states desperate to develop? How do you convince them to forgo their development opportunities? Well, perhaps through benefit sharing arrangements. And then the duty to cooperate, Article 8.1 of the Convention talks about mutual benefit, optimal utilization, adequate protection. And of course, Article 8.2 then stresses the use of joint mechanisms or commissions. The evolution of ecosystem protection, international water law, one minute. I won't spend too long on that because we understand, you know, this has been going all the way back to, for example, Chapter 18 of Agenda 21, the various conventions. They all now include ecosystem protection as a core obligation. But the means of implementation are what's important. We're starting to get a handle on it. So, you know, the guidance, the kinds of technical guidance which are developing, you know, through international organizations, this is what's really, really important to know. So in terms of an ecosystems approach, we can start with guidance under UNECE from 1994. Environmental flows, we see now included in a number of agreements, for example, recently amended 319 of the Colorado Treaty. The statements of the court, the findings of the tribunal in the Kishinganga arbitration, statements from the ICJ in the San Juan River case, etc. But we have a host of guidance on what environmental flows mean, and I've just listed some of them here. Ecosystem services, again, you know, this became the key paradigm after the Millennium Ecosystem Assessment of 2005, gave us a typology of types of ecosystem services, four categories of ecosystem services, gave us a way of thinking about ecosystem services. And of course, we have a whole host of guidance, slightly less around payment for ecosystem services, but they're starting to develop. Again, that's more and more complex and sophisticated. But so again, all of this type of thought power, if you like, is Okay, so just to finish off, paying for ecosystem services in lieu of ecological benefits, right? So how do we manage this? Well, you know, ecological benefits have been long recognized in benefit sharing. Issue linkage can take place, and this is called the sell-off in grain. Issue linkage can take place where a common currency, or is it Richard Paisley, might be Paisley, where a common currency is developed regarding those benefits, some sort of a common understanding. Which benefits are we counting? How do we understand them? This idea of common understandings. And this common currency is rapidly developing, I would argue, because of the kinds of technical gains and thought power that is emerging in the international community. So benefit sharing can assist in crafting complex benefit sharing arrangements focused on ecosystems protection, rather than, as up to this point, rather than facilitating interstate cooperation to enable the development of ecologically harmful infrastructure such as hydropower. Thank you.
Thank you very much for highlighting this very interesting aspect of benefit sharing and looking at ecosystems as a new way of interesting states into sharing benefits. Before we take questions, I would like to say that I introduced Owen as Dr. Owen McIntyre because I was reading the program, but in fact, I should have called you Professor Owen McIntyre. So we've got some time for some questions, and I see some hands already. Yes, we mentioned.
The idea of ecosystem services is quite good. We have seen in our cases, some of the river does not even carry the quantum required to have with environmental flows. So how to negotiate that? Like in case of fisher work, I am not sure, but the minimum flow really meets the requirement of inflow.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
What's the real scenario here?
Well, I mean, in Kishinganga, I think what one hears is that the flow requirements were not necessarily ecological flows, you know what I mean? They were flows required for economic development downstream, for hydropower development downstream was one of the key concerns. But, I mean, these methodologies are really developing. They're only really starting. I was involved through an accountability mechanism for a multilateral development bank not too very long ago. Again, a question of flows and flow management. In the context of a hydropower plant. And I was amazed to find out how basic the methodologies that existed were for measuring flow. We were using the Tennant method, which is an American method going back to the 1940s, I think, or something. So you know, these methodologies, they need a huge amount of work, huge amount. But what I'm saying is, my point is that we're not there, not nearly there, but there is now a focus on this. There are groups, one of the bodies that I didn't have time to look at there in detail, to look at these particular types of guidance, is the International Environmental Flow Network, I think it's called. So it's from a range of NGOs, WWF, IUCN, I can't remember exactly the number, but there are four or five bodies collaborating on this to try and find out how to develop, you know, what are the key parameters, what are the key objectives, how do you measure it, how do you take account of precaution in setting targets. So that's exactly the kind of debate we need to be having. You know, like if you think about it, it's 20 years since the, well, more or less, 18 years since the adoption of the UN Watercourses Convention, since the inclusion of Article 20 on ecosystems protection, it's about time we started to think about what does this mean? How can you give effect to it? We need technical methodologies that are credible and accepted. And that's, at least there's a movement in that direction towards doing that. And I'm not saying that we won't get it spectacularly wrong or we'll pilot times, you know what I mean? But that's how you learn as well.
Thanks, Owen, for
the
presentation.
And
I have one comment and one question.
Can you speak up a bit?
Yeah. So the comment is, you mentioned that you need to have really sophisticated legal institutional frameworks in place across the basin to have a good benefit sharing system in place. And that, I mean, I definitely agree with you there, but what's really interesting is in some of the research we're doing on the Spillanex project, we're going into lots of different indigenous communities around the world and seeing, like, for example, last week, some field research we did in Namibia, and the indigenous people there have really sophisticated benefit sharing framework on how they manage their resources without any kind of legal and institutional frameworks in place. And of course, that's not the same across the boundaries between two countries, but it does make us question how far we need to have that formalized arrangement in place to create such a complex sharing arrangement. So that's my point. The question is, I mean, you realize I'm working on this stuff as well, and I'm wondering how do we create a legal framework which really links water and non-water related benefits within the basin and out with international law. This is the really challenging.
Yeah.
Do you have any thoughts on that?
Yeah, I mean, I can't, as a question, that's a very difficult one to answer. I mean, I have a couple of examples of what's happening internationally in that regard. But let me go back to your first comment. I mean, I'm basically drawing a lesson here from, if you go back to the Columbia River Treaty, where, you know, it becomes very, very clear that for states, and they were looking at a very simple issue, which was basically Canada allowing some of its territory to be used for storage, if you know what I mean, for a reservoir, so for certain areas to be flooded, and for the US to pay royalties, and then for there to be concessionary preferential arrangements regarding electricity generated being re-exported back into Canada. And even for sort of a single issue, benefit sharing like that, that took tremendous sort of cooperation, really deep cooperation involving engineers and economists, and, you know, because it's a cross-border issue and there are questions of sovereignty and everything else involved, all of those very tricky concepts. And so it took real sort of institutional heft to get that across the line. So when you start you know, issue linkage beyond water, etc., imagine how sophisticated that's going to be. You're going to have some kind of a common language, or what it's either Paisley or Sadoff and Gray talked called a common currency. So some understanding of which issues are directly enough related, are close enough, are proximate enough to be counted. And then how do we count them? How do we value them? How much benefit do we attribute to one state's actions or one state's foregoing development? That's really likely to take a lot of communication. Do you know what I mean? A great deal of communication and institutions to develop that communication of trust. In terms of non-water issues, I mean, one of the things, as I said, I started working on this in China last summer. And one of the interesting issues that you noticed there was that China was prepared to talk to its southern neighbors about foregoing further development of a number of the shared rivers, the Lankang, Mekong, the Salween, and a number of these other rivers. But China is not necessarily expecting financial compensation from what would be its significantly poorer southern neighbors, mostly. Poorer southern neighbors, but it's thinking more in terms of political or of geopolitical influence of you know, common sort of integrated infrastructure, energy networks, and markets. You know what I mean? It's thinking rather than, so it's not impossible. Now, of course, you may have a hegemon, you may who has you know, grand economic ambitions in the region and stuff like that. That helps because they know exactly what they want and they can seek to sort of make a very strong case for that. But it's possible. And of course, that does raise other issues around unequal bargaining power and stuff as well that we did acknowledge.
Any more questions for Owen? Yes, Owen, what
extent you're also looking beyond the state. State benefit sharing, because I guess in international water law and transboundary water courses, we tend to think of one country or three countries buying a downstream country. But many of the disputes around water uses and the livelihood and ecological implications of them go beyond the state to state agreements. So, both in terms of the types of benefits that we're talking about, and then the I guess elaborating the institutional mechanism. Does your work see this as the kind of next step, or is it something which is ongoing in your?
So, if I understand your question, that the institutional mechanisms could, for example, allow a way in to the process for civil society and other groups? Is it, this is your question? Well, yes, actually, I mean, but I think that's already happening. That's already happening internationally. You know, that we have a slight dilemma. I know we talked about this, I mentioned this in a session in the workshop earlier this week, that we still have this formal parameters of international law is as a state-to-state paradigm. But that is breaking down, and we all recognize that it's breaking down. I think where we're a little bit behind in our thinking is trying to theorize that. Why is it breaking down? You know, in what way, how do we justify the permeability, if you like, of international law down to the domestic level and of non-state actors feeding up into international law? We've many, many examples of where non-state actors do feed into this whole process. I mean, there's a number of ways in which that can happen. For example, the human right to water discourse, the rights of indigenous people, etc., which are rights protected in international law largely. So there are a number of ways that could happen. I think it would be unacceptable in the vast majority of sort of political environments. It would be unacceptable if there were not roots in for stakeholders into these types of processes. I can't see in, you know, anywhere, say within Europe or North America or, you know, many other of the more developed parts of the world, it just couldn't happen. It wouldn't be allowed to happen politically. And then in developing countries where you may not, in some developing countries where you may not have a very, very highly developed sort of, you know, culture of stakeholder engagement, donors, etc., would not allow it. If donors were supporting a process, I imagine, or at least they'd be leaving themselves wide open to all sorts of criticism. If you had, you know, complex benefit sharing arrangements that involved everything from, you know, questions of economic development, indigenous rights, access to energy, etc., and there was no stakeholder engagement in that, well, you'd be asking for trouble. So I don't think that's impossible. And I think it's already happening. We're not all that clear on how and why that happens and how we characterize it in international law. But again, you know, it's happening. We just have to understand it.
Could I just say on that, maybe that's one of the opportunities. I think we've identified a number of the folks that have been here all week, I certainly have, where we need to look again at that interface between national and international law. I mean, there's a theoretical dimension, but there's also a practical one.
Yeah.
So I think that's something that the international and the national communities need to be working for.
My own kind of perspective on this, that I quite like global administrative law. I quite like this idea of you know, the increasing normativization of a whole sort of a suite of good governance values. And you see this happening a lot of the time where, you know, we appear often, actors appear to be less concerned to look at the formal legal provenance of a value. And just sort of these values almost come at us out of the ether, you know what I mean, in terms of transparency, in terms of there's an assumption that these are required values. That's only as a way of trying to explain what's happening, you know what I mean?
I think on this note, we'll end this first part of the morning session. Once again, thank you very much. And I'd now like to invite Professor Philip Hirsch of the University of Sydney to now look at a particular basin, the Mekong, and the social legal approach to river basin development there. So, Philip, the floor is yours.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thanks, Alistair, for our kind of invitation to present today. A couple of caveats before I start. One is that I teach geography and not law. The other is that the project and the book that's come out of it that I'm going to be talking about today is not specifically about international water law. In fact, it's not even specifically about international law. Rather, it's about the place of law in decisions and outcomes within an international river basin. So it may be a fine distinction, but I think it's an important one to make in this is by way of preface. What I'm going to be talking about today is a project that has set out to look at the way in which law is part of governance, part of society in the Mekong River Basin, and particularly in the way in which law comes into decision making over hydropower projects. There's a number of issues which I think follow on very directly from the questions around benefit sharing, but they go well beyond those. We're looking at the Mekong as an international river basin, specifically as a what we call a socio-legal entity. And the project we've been trying to put together over the last few years in a collaboration between geographers and law academics is to see what it means to conceive a river basin as a socio-legal entity. Of course, there are many different constructions of a river and a river basin. You can think of rivers as flows and connections in their naturalistic sense. But even here, flows and connections immediately evokes and brings up legal questions because of the ways in which actions in one part of a basin or on one length of a river impacts on other users of the river. Again, building on the previous presentation. There's also, of course, when we start to look not just at the river, but the river basin and the degree of overlap, but also difference between that the boundaries of that basin and the political entities that define national law within the basin, we see that there's a tension in jurisdiction, which again brings out important legal questions. There's also the issue of a river basin as a basis for life, livelihoods, and also the if you like the sort of symbolic and cultural meanings of the basin, which raises questions around rights, obligations that go beyond the formally defined legislation that define the use of a river. There's, of course, river basins as a part of a geopolitical system in terms of the relative hegemonic relations between countries, sometimes upstream, downstream, sometimes downstream, upstream, and so on. And so there are many ways in which we construct the idea of a river and river basin, all of which have got legal components and elements to them. But in this book, we look a bit more directly at the Mekong River Basin as a transnational river basin that is also a socio-legal entity. And in looking at law in the basin, we look beyond the international law that defines relations and shapes relations between states. We look at the law at the national level, we look at customary law. In fact, as a socio-legal exercise, we're looking at law plurally. We're looking at law as, if you like, a continuum along a spectrum of norms, expectations, obligations, some of which are enshrined in legislation, some of which are dealt with through the courts, but many or most of which tend to occur in societal processes well beyond the legal architecture at national and international level within the basin. So we're looking at law plurally and beyond the formal institutions, and we're trying to do so within a particular geography, that is the basin. The project on which the book I'm going to talk about in a moment is based is one that's funded by the Australian Research Council, which has been ongoing for the last 3.5 years. And the title of the project is Mekong Law, Scale, Sites and Impacts of Hard and Soft Law in the Mekong River. Like many research projects, this is kind of the project has evolved along the way. It involves three law academics, some of whom I know you know personally and through their work, and Ben Bora, now retired, but not really retired, professor of environmental law at the University of Sydney, and then two international lawyers, being in Seoul, who's very active in human rights law, and Flora John, who's also an international lawyer, but works particularly in international corporate law and transboundary or transnational investment, and then two of us geographers, myself, having worked in the Mekong Basin for quite a long time, and being interested to take the socio-political analysis of river basin issues into the law. The overarching aim of our project has been to understand how the various rules, institutions, ideas, vocabularies around law operate in decision making and distributional outcomes in the Mekong. And we use the ideas of hard and soft law, but we also try to break them down a bit and look critically at the distinction between them. We find that in our work that what started off as a fairly clear distinction in our minds has become increasingly fuzzy, as we found, for example, that there are many so-called soft law procedures and, if you like, cultures of use of law, particularly in the Southeast Asian context, where the so-called ASEAN way is often assumed to be a very soft way of dealing things, or where the Mekong River Commission is seen to work in a very soft way of doing things, to find that, in fact, the power of what we call soft law through the expectations, the obligations that come with it, are sometimes more firm than the so-called hard law, which is also very brittle and can be quite superficial in terms of what it really means and does and performs. So one of the things that we've tried to do in this project through a series of about 53 in-depth interviews and case studies around the region is to look at the way in which a very wide variety of actors in the Mekong turn to law or turn away from law, understand law, look to law within the suite of tools or devices that they have to pursue their ends. We look at the what law means to different stakeholders and the way in which law is embedded, taking a socio-legal approach within the societal means of dealing with issues that are contested, particularly around hydropower, and then look at some of the outcomes of the ways in which they do so. We also, in the project right at the beginning, sought to attest and look critically at some of the more common assumptions about the relationship between law and development, particularly the more linear assumptions of the move from soft to hard law, of the ideas that what development involves is a firming up of law, more law. In fact, what we found in our review was a great deal of law, that law imbues many processes, but perhaps in some unexpected ways and non-conventional ways. And so we also then look critically at some of the development interventions around law and expectations of donors and others around law, that the main task is simply to put more law into the arena. So these are some of the case studies we're looking at. Now, we're not suggesting that hydropower is everything and anything and all things when it comes to questions around law in Mekong River Basin development, but nevertheless, this is where a lot of the contestation occurs. And I guess more importantly, these dams and suites of dams and institutions around dams are windows into trying to understand the ways in which law is used by different actors for different means. They provide, excuse the pun, very concrete examples of how law actually operates. So we don't structure the book around case studies. Rather, these case studies come in and out of the throughout the book that we've written out of this project. So we lay these five suites of dams up front in the introduction to the book. I won't go through all the reasons of time, I won't go through them all, obviously. But I guess what these maps and these lists show is that there's a great deal of hydropower development that's gone on, even more that's going on, and even more that is set to go on the Mekong River's tributaries, but now also on the mainstream. I believe Alistair is looking at a slide, you may be touching on one or two of the cases here as well. So here's a very quick list of the chapters. I won't go through through them all. There's a, I think, a flyer that's gone around describing what the book is about. And what we try to do, particularly through these chapters from three onwards, is to look at the action around law, both historically at the making of the Mekong River Basin as a legal and socio-legal entity, right from colonial times through to the more recent institutions, not only the Mekong River Commission, but also the various procedures that come with international development banks, safeguards, expectations, obligations that are, we see as much as as legal stuff as the formal international water law, and then also the law that comes around an increasingly privatized activity. One of the, I think, where there's a, still a lot of room for development of thinking in this area, one of the, I guess, habits is to think of large dams as a large, as a mainly public arena, whereas almost all of the investment in these dams is actually private. So it brings a whole new dimension of law and body of legal concern to the issue. So we look at the historical making of the basin, and then we also look at the interface between law and governance through a case study of the Mekong River Commission, looking at the ways in which not only the rules and procedures that are part of the MRC's work, but also the scientific technical work of the Mekong River Commission has its own politics, has its own way of setting particular kinds of outcomes. We follow this idea of what we call politics of the technical into the realm of environmental impact assessment and look at the politics around that. And then the sixth chapter, disclosing river basin, we look at the question of international norms around transparency, participation, and so on that that come with particular projects, often with what we see as kind of enclave projects, islands of governance, where we find particular governance legal regimes built around projects, Numten 2, supported by the World Bank and completed in the mid-2000s is a major case study involved here. And then we also look at the different ways in which civil society actors use law, not so much or really not very much at all through the courts, but rather use law in their vocabularies, in their challenges, in their appeals to government, in their appeals to donor organizations and so on. So again, we see law when you look at it through this lens as much more pervasive than it is often assumed. And then, and I realize the time's moving on, so I'll just run through these very, very quickly. In the conclusion to the book, we've challenged, I guess we've distilled our findings from this look at law and its place in river basin development into challenges to what we found through our interviews, through our readings, and through our own experience, as a number of quite pervasive assumptions, not only pervasive in the international development community, but also among NGOs and sometimes in the legal community as well. One is the assumption that in the Mekong River Basin, which is the lower part of which is entirely within ASEAN, the Association of Southeast Asian Nations, there's often an assumption that that law is weak, that there's a culture of non-regulation, non-interference, and that sovereign prerogative trumps law, that somehow law remains exogenous to social and legal life. But in fact, we find that this is a very superficial reading, and we find in various ways that different actors turn to law, that this assumption of the ASEAN way is one that's now very problematic. We also find ways in which even national law does confront and constrain sovereign power, even in some of the more authoritarian states. So there's an interplay, there's a politics, there's a dynamic which is there, which is often missed in the kind of sometimes dichotomous way of thinking of soft and hard law, of like the modern law and ASEAN ways of doing things, and so on. There's also sometimes an assumption that informal issues, informal negotiations, relations and privileges tend to trump rules and standards. But in fact, we find that a lot of negotiation continues to appeal to legal norms, even though, as I said before, it's often not the formal legal institutions or the courts that ultimately are the arbiters. Nevertheless, legal principles and vocabularies are there. I've already talked about the soft and hard ones. It's often an assumption, and it's sometimes borne out, but far from ubiquitously, that law serves powerful elites to the detriment and exclusion of others consistently and reliably. But again, we find a dynamic in which law is appropriated. It's law can be oppressive, and it can be empowering, and it's in some kind, in Cambodia in particular, through civil society organizations, through particular cultures of confrontation that are hard to find elsewhere in the region, we find that there are many instances in which law has been taken up and applied in various contested schemes. The biggest of those at the moment is the law 672 down in Cambodia. This probably applies more to the international donor community than to others. There's often an assumption that if international law was somehow implemented better in the Mekong region, it would come up with just or juster outcomes for all. But we find that, in fact, some of the blueprints of so-called best practice remain just that and very, very superficial. We also find risks of the sometimes perverse application of international law norms, for example, around participation, which this is an issue which is has been written about extensively beyond the legal or socio-legal arena, but we find that when we look at the law as norms, that the application of these norms can lead to perverse and disempowering outcomes as well. And I think I'll, in the interest of time, and being able to wrap up now, I guess I'll just quote from our conclusion, that the book takes issue with the idea that political and economic life in the Mekong region somehow just awaits greater juridification, more law to displace this unrestrained sovereign politics or countervail unequal accumulation of capital and so on. And in doing so, we also question some of the templates that come within the law and development approach within river basins and more widely in the field of international development.
Well, Philip, thank you very much for introducing your project. I'm certainly looking forward to reading the book when it's out. I think it's interesting for us lawyers, particularly, we spend a lot of time thinking about the content of the law, but then we want to know what happens to it once it's there and how people perceive it and what impact it has in a basin or wherever it is. So thank you very much for that. Now, do we have any questions for Philip? Yes, please.
First, thank you very much for your nice presentation. But I have a small question about your nearly last slide. Now, this one, the previous, I think it was. I didn't understand the significant risk of the application of international standards, and you mentioned participation. Do you mean public participation, or do you mean something else? Because I didn't get that point.
Thanks. Yeah, actually, that's not a small point. It's very important point. So thank you for the question and the chance to elaborate. Maybe I'll bring up the one of the specific examples that we go into some detail on in the book, and that is the case of the World Bank facilitated public participation processes around a well-known dam, the Nanterre 2 dam that was built in Laos. It's a public-private partnership, but that came with World Bank money and sovereign risk guarantees. And as a result, it's one of those projects that does continue to have the leverage of an international organization bringing international norms, requirements, operational standards, and so on. One of those was public consultation ahead of the dam, during the dam, and in the follow-up. What we found through our own research as part of this project, and also through the work that others have done on the participation standards, is that there's a great deal in the so-called participatory work among communities in the basin that is superficial, that is really just a performance rather than a participation. And when we talk here about the question of patching this onto existing modes of governance, this is happening within a country, Laos, which within an already relatively authoritarian region has got the most authoritarian government and the least opportunity for safe challenge to policy, and especially to high profile projects such as this. What we found, in fact, as part of a short visit to communities that have been involved in the participation processes, is that despite the other hardships around changes to life and livelihood, access to resources and so on, that have created difficulties as a result of this dam, the most strident complaint that came to us speaking to people in their own language was having to get up and perform in front of international participation experts and visitors and others. So this is actually one of the sort of material hardships and the, if you like, the fundamental hardships that people had to go through, the pretense that's involved in it. So that's just a bit of an explanation of what I mean, some of the perverse application that's risk. Now, that's not to suggest that public participation isn't important, but it is to say that it's much more than putting rules there. And this is where a socio-legal approach tries to look at the meanings of such processes and requirements.
Yeah, short sentence. I completely agree with you that the process and more like its performance, that's the real public participation and many other things are involved. But there are, because you already mentioned that there is a fund from international institutions, so they can, I think, adjust the public participation. And also there are some cases, for instance, the Chad Cameron oil pipeline. That pipeline also was, not about the water, but about something else. But also environmental impact assessment was mandatory for that project by the International Monetary Fund, if I'm correct. And they did several times, and even if the people who were in charge of the environmental impact assessment was under the supervision or control of the government, but still the fund did not approve that environmental impact assessment and then asked them to try again. And then the final result was much more better than the previous one. So I totally agree with you that it depends on the many other things. That it's not possible that they are not all in those. But I mean, there could be some compromise.
The question from Remy Kina at the Oxfam office in Yom Penn. So he asks, given the recent failure of the MRC Joint Committee to reach a decision on the Don Sahong Dam, is it giving rise to questions from donors and others on the role and relevance of the MRC in the Mekong Agreement? And what's your view on the future governing of the Mekong, especially given entry into force of the Watercourses Convention and its role alongside the Mekong Agreement and the MRC?
Well, thanks for that small question, Ryan.
That's
Quick background for those who don't know about the Don Sahong Dam. The Don Sahong Dam is the second of the dams that Laos is now going ahead with on the lower Mekong mainstream. Perhaps it's one that you're talking about when you talk about notification and prior consultation. The first one was Sayaburi. And the failure that Remy is referring to is that normally, under the prior consultation requirements, the joint committee is supposed to achieve agreement. It couldn't, so it then was bounced up to the Mekong Council, and that's supposed to achieve agreement. It couldn't. All three other countries, Thailand, Cambodia, and Vietnam, objected. And now it's been bumped up again to the governmental level, which in many ways is a failure because it means that the MRC's own governance structures is unable to come up with an agreement. Others would say, well, this is not a failure because that's provided for under the 1995 agreement. But it's clearly a failure within the time frame of the prior consultation and within the framework to come up with an agreement. In fact, there isn't even an agreement on the Sayaburi dam. It just the process dissipated and the dam is being built. This comes at a very difficult time for the MRC as well, because the donors are now saying that they're going to reduce funding more quickly than they were going to before, and certainly this whole fiasco will have fed into that. With regard to the 1997 Watercourses Convention, of course, Vietnam's accession was a trigger for it to come into operation, which is very significant. It's the only Southeast Asian country, I think, the only Asian country to be a member, and it's not surprising as a downstream member. I think there's very little likelihood that the other Mekong countries will become members any time soon. If there's one sort of glimmer of significance or hope in Vietnam becoming a convention, I think it's this, and it's not really one that's talked about very much. It's that, and coming from Cambodia, Remy, I'm sure you'll be, you'll recognize this, that Vietnam is, of course we want to be a member, we're a downstream country, but Vietnam is also an upstream country. Vietnam, the first really severe transboundary impact of dam building in the Mekong River Basin didn't come on the mainstream with China's building. It came because of Vietnam's construction of Yali Falls and other dams in the Central Highlands. And Vietnam now has 12 or 13 dams on the Se San and Se Phoc rivers with severe impacts downstream in Cambodia, where Rim is coming in from. So in that sense, it gives some leverage perhaps to maybe not the Cambodian government being expected to act, but to Cambodian civil society to then call Vietnam for its commitments under the convention. It's a bit difficult to make that call now that almost all the dams have really been built, but at least the ways in which they're operated could be one particular way in which leverage for the 1997 convention could be utilised.
I think we had a question earlier, yes.
My understanding of your presentation, if I may summarize it, that even though there is an international law exists, but the political, social, legal, and other aspects at the country level, that is a big challenge to implement the international agreement down there. What about the politics of technical you mentioned there, you said the
okay, so so forgive me, I've tried to summarize a book and 3 years of work in a very short period of time, and so I guess the messages tend to be a bit conflated. So certainly the message, as you nicely tried to summarize it, is one of those, but it goes well beyond difficulty in implementing international law. It's as much about national law, about customary law, as it is about other dimensions and scales of law. The question about the politics of the technical, we raised particularly in chapter 4, where we look at the Mekong River Commission, whose work is sometimes thought of in two distinct arenas, one being the setting of procedures and rules, for example, the procedures for notification, prior consultation, and agreement, the so-called PNPCA that governs the building of dams on Mekong and mainstream and tributaries. And then on the other hand, the technical work, the science that is done. Our book, and this chapter in the book, tries to break down that distinction, showing that the particular ways in which science, knowledge, and models are brought to decision making have their own politics. The ways in which the questions of water allocation, of appropriate uses of water are framed, has an enormous implication for the setting plans and construction of projects. And just one very quick example, and at the time's running on, and that is the one of the core concepts in the Mekong River Commission's basin development plan is something called development opportunity space. And it sounds like a very technical word, but based on the idea that some of the macro level models, it shows that a certain amount of water can be used for hydropower generation, for irrigation in the wet season and so on, with acceptable levels of impact downstream. And so it's taking this block of water and then doing something with it. But that idea of the socio-technical framing of this development opportunity space in pure hydrological terms is very problematic in when you take an ecological or socio-ecological approach that looks at values in fisheries, in values in subsistence livelihoods, and so on. So the particular technical framing through the kinds of models that lie behind the big picture concepts like development opportunity space have a politics to them in the way in which they promote and legitimize a particular way of developing and using the base. So that's in a nutshell, that's what we're getting at.
Well, I know there are a couple more questions, but I'm going to ask you to keep your questions for the break. Philip, thank you very much for your presentation and for talking to us about the work you've done in the Mekong. So please join me. Now I invite Alistair, who's going to talk to us about recent case law and in particular prior notification and consultation in the context of plan measures. Alistair.
Thank you, Zaki. Okay, well, good morning once again, everyone. Yeah, this is really, I guess our centre has been focusing a lot more on transboundary hydropower. One of our former PhD students just published a book on sort of a role of civil society, NGOs, and within the Mekong context, influencing focus on the Zayaburi, Yumiko Yasuda. I've been doing some work on sort of looking at the interface between, Phil mentioned this, sort of international investment law, sort of private, the rules and principles around that, private companies vis-a-vis the states developing these projects, the human rights sort of
for rights of individuals and communities. And I've also been looking at the Zaiburi case, and then I started looking more generally at issues around notification and consultation. And reading some of the recent cases, you find that there's a lot of lessons I think you can learn in interpreting the general rules and principles in international law around this area. So that's what I'd like to present a bit to you today. I think it's really important. I mean, we all know we have huge number of transboundary river basins. We're all reliant on them, and there's a big challenge in terms of, you know, we don't have comprehensive basin-specific agreements in each a river basin, and you could argue whether you need sort of whether there's a one-size-fits-all kind of basin approach. But regardless of that discussion, we can say that a lot of these basins are reliant on the rules and principles of customary international law in their dealings around these types of large infrastructure projects. So what I wanted to find out is really, what is the customary international law in this field? What does the UN Watercourses Convention say? And then what is the contribution of some of the recent cases? I won't talk too much about the convention itself and how it evolved and its status, or the cases. I'm going to zoom in on the rules and principles on notification and consultation, but you can delve into more detail after the presentation if you so wish. So just to start with the Watercourses Convention, so Schwebel, one of the special rapporteurs developing the draft text of the convention, introduced this notion of notification and consultation, serving a wide range of state practice and basically coming to a conclusion, but most of it's pretty general. And so he took the initiative to suggest in the first, his first proposal was to have pretty detailed rules or procedural rules on notification and consultation. And they actually, more or less, you know, there was a lot of negotiation in the draft, in the development through the IRC, in the negotiation in the sixth committee of the General Assembly. But ultimately, a lot of that detail remained. So you'll see in Article 12 of the Watercourses Convention, it talks about plan measures, projects, and programs. It talks about who to notify. When to notify, I'll pause here, emphasize, before a watercourse state implements or permits the implementation of plan measures, it shall provide timely notification. So already here, a question on what timely means. What to share, it says available technical data and information, including the results of any EIA. Bit different to saying you must conduct an EIA, but if one is available, then you should share it. And additional information if requested. How long to reply? 6 months, it's stipulated in the convention, but a request, if there's a request for additional time, then a further 6 months can be granted. Obligations on the notifying state during the notified period, no implementation of the plan measure without consent of a notified state. That's another important issue that we'll come back to. Then there's a duty to consult if there is a disagreement on the impacts of the plan measure. So you enter into consultations, and during that period of consultation, again, if requested by the notified state, notifying state should refrain from implementation of the project for a further 6 months, can proceed, of course, ensuring that the planned use must always be consistent with the substantive norms of international water law, as articulated in Article 5 and 7 of the UN Watercourses Convention, equitable reasonable use and no significant harm. Where there's no agreement, well, there's detailed procedures for settlement of dispute in the convention. So the convention was significant. I mean, as I say, very detailed procedures, and so a really important step forward. But you can also raise a number of interpretive questions on this, you know, whether timely, you know, could you have clarified that a little bit more? Finland in the negotiation, for example, drawing from their experience in the ESPU convention, said, well, maybe we should define that as early as possible and no later than when informing notifying state informs their own public of the plan measure. But that didn't find itself, wasn't incorporated into the convention. What to share EIA, you know, only if available, could that have been stronger? And I think you can make a very strong argument, and as we'll see, it comes up in one of the cases, that there is now an obligation to conduct a joint EIA. Obligations on the planning state during notification consultation and any dispute settlement, refrain from implementing the project. You know, what constitutes the actual plan measure? Again, that came up in the cases, and we'll look at that. And what happens during arbitration and adjudication? Are you still obliged to suspend the project? So the first one I want to look at is the Port Mills case. And as I say, I'm not going to go into the details of the case. I haven't got time, but you can find that. You'll find the detail elsewhere. So there's a 97 Uruguay statute that sets out procedures for notification, consultation, dispute settlement, and there's the Joint Commission carried the pulp mills here on the Uruguay River, a question of the impact in on the Argentinian side. Uruguay plans to construct pulp mills were seen as an alleged breach by Argentina of the procedural and substantive rules of the Uruguay statute. The second case I want to look at is the Kishinganga. So based on the 1960 Indus Treaty, the impact of the plans in India to build a hydropower scheme, questions on impact in Pakistan. Lots of issues in both cases, lots of detail. I'll not go into it. I'm zooming in on the notification and consultation issues. When to notify? So in the Uruguay case, there was first this duty to the pulp mills case, under the Uruguay statute, the question of inform, you must inform. So the commission determines the Uruguay should inform the CARU, the commission, and then they determine if there is a need for a further notification. So already that's interesting. It's a bit more than the Watercourses Convention. It's sort of putting a few more milestones in the process. Inform, we'll evaluate at a preliminary stage, and then we'll decide whether it's necessary to notify. And Uruguay said the early stage requirement was unrealistic. You know, we just didn't know what we weren't really sure what we were going to do. So why should we share information at that stage? But the international court said no, as soon as it's in possession of a plan which is sufficiently developed to enable CARU to make a preliminary assessment, that's the trigger. And that should take place at a stage when the relevant authority has had the project referred to it with the aim of obtaining an initial environmental authorization and before the granting of the authorization. No need for a full assessment to make that initial determination. So I think a really important bit more detail there in terms of, you know, that what we mean by timely notifications and good guidance, I think. Pulp mills, but the court was very strong saying you must conduct a transboundary EIA. The question on the content they didn't go into, and we could talk a lot about how much guidance international law provides on what must be contained within the scope and the content of the EIA. But here, I think just to note that certainly strengthened the need of an EIA and complemented the interpretation of a Watercourses Convention, I think, when it said if an EIA is available, you should share it. And suspension of works, I think, is a really key issue. And a lot of discussion here in the pulp mills case, any activities by the notifying state during the period of notification should not be permitted. That was very set out very clearly by the International Court of Justice. So preliminary works on sites, not an exception, an integral part of the construction. But you see here a little bit of a disagreement between the judges. So a separate opinion by Judge Greenwood saying, well, I actually think that clearing vegetation, leveling land, preparing foundations, unlikely in itself to have any adverse impact. So parties run the risk that they prove to be wasted. So well, maybe state, you know, that should that really be part of the project itself? So you can see a good discussion here around what, you know, what's allowed, but you can see not quite a definitive answer in terms of what really should be suspended. Also in the Keshanganga case, in the Permanent Court of Arbitration, Pakistan requested from India the suspension of construction while the case was heard. And the Permanent Court of Arbitration said, well, boring tunnels and building of a powerhouse does not appear to be necessary to safeguard its ability to render an effective award. So it's governed by the proceed at own risk principle again. So you can do some of the construction as long as it doesn't have an interference. It's slightly different. This is taking place within the remit of the timescale of hearing the dispute, whereas the notification suspension of works in the pulp mills, that reference is to that notification period. But you can see there's this sort of questions coming out around what should be permitted and what shouldn't be permitted. And it came up also in the Gavtikova Najmarov case in the ICJ, this own risk principle. Czechoslovakia can develop a project, but not put it into operation without consent of Hungary. So a wrongful act or offense is frequently preceded by preparatory actions, which are not to be confused with the action itself. So again, this is sort of question in terms of the extent to which states can develop a project during the dispute settlement process. So we talked about the sort of this issue around during the notification period, but then Argentina also, when the case came before the International Court of Justice, asked for provisional measures to prevent the further development of the pulp mill, and Uruguay bears the claim, so decision Uruguay bears all risks related to any finding on the merits that the court might later make, whereas the court points out that the construction at the current site cannot be deemed a fait accompli. So when they decided on the provisional measures, they said, well, Uruguay, you can go ahead, but if we decide that some of your actions are unlawful, then you may have to redress that at your own cost. So Argentina's claim, so notified party raises objection, the other party may neither carry out nor authorize the work in question until the procedure laid down in the statute has been completed and the court has ruled on the project. And so this is sort of related question in terms of, you know, when does the suspension of works continue throughout the whole, so notification period, the consultation period, and then when the dispute is being heard by an international court. So the ICJ said, well, the state initiating the plan may, at the end of the negotiation period, proceed with the construction of its own risk. So they said, okay, so during negotiation, the notification negotiation, no, but then when it goes to court, you can proceed at your own risk. But again, a little bit of disagreement on this issue as well. And a couple of the International Court of Justice judges said, well, the court should step in before a project is realized. We should embrace a preventive rather than a compensatory logic when determining what the risk might entail. So you can see that maybe there's some opinion there saying, well, maybe particularly in these environmental cases where it is hard to address some of these harms, but prevention is better. So, in conclusion, we see significant detail in the Watercourses Convention around notification and consultation. There's still a number of interpretive questions, when to notify. I think pulp mills gave a bit more guidance on that, which is very helpful. What to notify, again, transboundary EIA, I think a nice clear statement there in terms of that it was a customary obligation. Maybe international environmental law, though, needs a bit more
detail in terms of scope and content of that joint EIA. I think there's still lots of challenges at the transboundary level in terms of setting up sufficient effective arrangements for conducting transboundary EIAs between states. Suspension of works, I mean, Paul Mills talked about integral, but the still a bit of dissenting opinion on what exactly is covered by the project, is it ground clearing, and so forth. Some clarification would help. Either way, more clarification would help. And provisional measures, tendency to rely on their own risk principle, but is that sort of a bit at variance with this notion of suspension of work? And I think you see a sort of some clarification, some more interpretive guidance, at least the cases give, but some more questions to ponder. More information, as I mentioned, is part of some research, which a lot more detail you'll find in this publication from the Yearbook of International Environmental Law. Thanks very much.
Alistair, thank you very much for reviewing the procedural rules and highlighting what's come up out of recent cases. I think these have very important implications for states when they're thinking about measures and when to notify and what happens when they've already started. That can have significant financial implications for them. So I'd now like to open for some questions for Alistair. Yes.
I think you talked about the notification and then straight away the things went to the court. So what about the consultation process and how did it take place, if you can give us some insights into it in either of the five cases or in the fiction agenda?
Yeah, I mean, if I can kind of premise it with the UN Watercourses Convention, and so for the notification period, there is that obligation to suspend works, and if there is a reply to notification that says, well, we want to enter into consultations, we're not sure of the we're concerned about the impact that this might have. The notified state is concerned about the impact that a certain use may have. So then there's a consultation period, which again there's the obligation to suspend works for 6 months, and then it goes to dispute settlement and it goes through the dispute settlement mechanism. The various options around through a third-party fact-finding commission is established under the Watercourses Convention, or it could go direct to arbitration or adjudication. And during that period, that third period, the convention doesn't say stop the suspend the works. You can basically work the notifying state can proceed. But they have to ensure that they're still in compliance with Articles 5 and 7. So then with the cases, then so under the Uruguay statute, you have the obligation to inform and notify, and during that period, there was this requirement to suspend works. But then when the case went to the International Court of Justice, then it's basically for the court then to decide what should happen. And that's why the states request provisional measures. So then that's when Argentina says, okay, we want the project to stop. And Uruguay say, no, it's come on, we're in the process of constructing the project. It will there'll be huge costs and delays. And so the court has to balance up. The court makes the decision at an early stage in the proceedings what to do about suspending the works. And so in the Pulp Mills case, they said, well, Uruguay can go ahead, but if we then decide that the project that they complete is
in breach of the commitments under the Uruguay statute to Argentina, we'll ask them to modify that project. Very similar in the Kishinganga case in the Permanent Court of Arbitration. So there was a notification, a negotiation, consultation period that went through through the terms of the Indus Treaty. But the Permanent Court of Arbitration was then faced with the same question. You know, should we, Pakistan's saying suspension, and then India saying, well, can we go ahead during the proceedings, which can take a long time, right? So the court there, again, so that's when the court steps in and says, we follow the own risk principle. You can't build the dam itself, but you know, the head tunnel, the powerhouse, etc., the infrastructure on your territory that won't in itself have an impact, the downstream impact, you can go ahead. So that's sort of the transition.
I don't see any more hands, but I have a question.
Yeah.
In an ideal situation, what would be the time that a state would want to notify another state that it's planning to take measures? I mean, would it be when the project is being considered within the state before too much work has been done, or?
Yeah, I mean, I didn't get a chance to talk about it in detail, but it's in the paper. The Kishinganga, the Permanent Court of Arbitration, sort of talked about this, that there was, you know, you kind of have false starts, delays in the project life cycle. So it's difficult to find an exact period. And they talked about firm intent. So when a culmination of facts came together, but I think the Port Mills case gave a bit more clarification, saying, you know, when you're conduct at the national level, you have and countries have clear rules and national laws on EIAs and around consulting potentially affected stakeholders, and so I think that kind of emphasis on sort of when you start consulting with your own citizens. Think about how that should. I think that's a good time to at least start the conversation and the discussion, and definitely before you authorize any project, and sort of allow allow some discussion. And again, sort of that message from Paul Mills, and actually within the design of the Uruguay statute, you know, having a few stages. You know, you inform just a preliminary saying this. Hey, this is our plan. You know, and then start. You know, that's sort of a nice kind of first step before, and not wait until you have all the facts. You're never going to have all the facts and figures there. So at least sort of maybe having a light notification to begin with. Think of it more as a progression of a conversation rather than one-off notification. More sort of an iterative approach. Yeah.
Okay. Yes.
Very good question. After your theme, does the request for a consultation, if there is concern in the downstream state, for example, have to come from state agencies, or can one state act or something like that request?
In customary international law, no, and in the Watercourses Convention, no. It's watercourse state to watercourse state. I mean, there's no reason why within a bilateral or basin specific treaty you could sort of embed that within the process, but it's not something you find in customary international law.
Just also a small question as a follow up. I presume many of these big projects, they have to follow standards of the, let's say, the World Bank or financial mechanisms that finance these big endeavors.
Yeah.
So I'm wondering whether there's also additional obligations under, let's say, safeguards of the World Bank to notify and to comply with customary international water law.
Yeah.
That doesn't come necessarily from customs, but comes more from the private standards.
Absolutely. Yeah. The World Bank safeguard procedures offer more. I mean, who to notify, for example, they say you, the requirement is you notify all basin states. The Watercourses Convention doesn't go as far as that. It says states that may be potential, where there may be a significant, there may be a significant adverse effect. You can think about the 17 basins or so on the Danube River. That if there's a project sort of quite far downstream, then maybe it will have no impact upstream. But you would still have to notify all those basin states. So you can see there's a bit more detail. There's more detail in the scope of an EIA and the content of the EIA, the processes for sure. But I think it's important to note that that's not customary international law, and you only have one. You have one regional convention on joint EIAs, the ESPU convention under the United Nations Economic Commission for Europe, and otherwise, it's a lot of states, as I said at the beginning, rely on customary international law, and you think not all big hydropower projects are funded by the development banks. Quite the opposite, they're the exception. So there's a question there. The safeguard policies don't fit in. There's some good soft law instruments. There's the International Hydropower Association and Sustainability Protocol provides guidelines, but it's guidance. It's not customary international law.
Okay, well, I think we're going to end the first part of this morning's session, and I'd like to thank again our speakers, Alistair, Owen, and Philip. Invite you all to a coffee break in the room next door, and we'll start again at 11:15 sharp.
Hello, hello, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2. Oh yeah, so there's a tiny little bar coming up. It's only coming up a little bit though, is that just...
So yeah, would you mind,
yeah,
so shall I send you the link? Or,
yeah, is it on the website?
Yeah, it's on the...
I searched for it through YouTube. Yeah. So just click that and share all of
yes. Yeah, okay, perfect.
Talk a little bit more about it, just give me a shout.
Wow.
Nice. So 30 minutes, right? You see what I do here in my PhD life. Let's see if you get it, right? What I want to do here is to get a little bit of feedback. So yeah, I think if you actually get it, then it would be interesting to get your feedback. Hopefully I get the Owens. I want to hear what the Ruby has to say about it. So think about it. See whether it's completely rubbish and you say, no, this is completely a waste of time, or whether it's good. Yeah, because we want to stay sharp.
Okay, everyone. We're going to start the second part of this morning's session, and I'm delighted to introduce Juan Carlos Sanchez of IUCN and a PhD student here in Dundee. I'm very much looking forward to your presentation, Juan Carlos. He's going to talk about an indicator-based approach to transboundary water governance. So, Juan Carlos, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Saki. Thank you very much, everyone, and also to the colleagues and to the people that are watching us via the internet, via what is it that we're using? Via YouTube. Okay. So what I wanted to get from this session, it's basically to present to you what I'm doing in my own research. So I would like you, if possible, to look at it from a critical perspective, also from a practical perspective. And I would like at the end of the presentation actually to get feedback from you on what I am actually researching on. So I think by now it's very clear that it's not only about the water. We're talking about a more integrated approach. Yesterday we talked about ecosystems approaches. So it's this integration of land, water, living organisms, abiotic components of the ecosystem managed together. This is a picture from the Huascarán River Basin, which is actually shared between El Salvador and Honduras. Honduras, as you might know, it's one of the most vulnerable countries, according to the indexes of climate change. So I wanted to bring this into perspective, because part of the research that I'm doing takes part not only on basins where all ecological factors, social factors, economical factors are there for, there are many challenges as well. And what we're trying to do, and part of the ideas in which I am based, is in this idea of using nature and natural capital also as an asset for cooperation. So I wanted to go back to this graphic that we presented yesterday, because I had the idea that the message that I wanted to put across was not very well understood. When we are talking about ecosystems approaches, we are not talking only about conservation. Let us be clear. If you want to put a word around it, it's closer to the idea of sustainable development rather than to conservation. The whole idea of having different types of services was shared under the current trends scheme, in which provision services are the ones that have, let's say, priorities. Agriculture, hydroelectric power, timber production, etc. These are the type of things, these are the type of uses that under current understandings of international water law have, let's say, a priority in regulation. If you would be coming from a only protection perspective, then you would be looking more at regulatory services, at the cultural services, and so on and so forth. But what we are talking about with ecosystem approaches is more of a balance. So if you would have to put it in a box, please put it in the box of sustainable development and not in the box only of protection and preservation, because it's not the same thing. So when we're talking about ecosystems approaches, let us think more of sustainable development, use of a provisioning services of the basin, but also making sure that we protect a minimum amount for benefit of new generations to come. So having said that, what I'm interested in researching is what are the legal and institutional arrangements and the key elements that have to be present in order to foster an ecosystems approach within transboundary river basins. So what are the within a legal regime, what are those things that have to be there in order to move from the current trend to a sustainable development trend? So how can treaties actually foster sustainable development, if you want? So having said that, I'm interested not only in the specific articles of the treaty, but also in the indigenous factors, not the indigenous factors that influence the capacity of treaties to support this ecosystems approach. So that has led me to identify three series of problems that, in my view, they are at the core of this issue. One is the problem of regime design. So what do I mean with this? It's exactly the letter of the articles. What type of rights and obligations do we need to have in a treaty in order to endorse the ecosystems approach? Second one, it's one of the issues that came up in the first session, the issue of fragmentation. So how can a water law treaty deal with other issues that might not be necessarily purely water, biodiversity, climate change, wetlands, which is in that gray zone, etc. So the issue of fragmentation is also important in my research. And finally, the issue of implementation capacity, because it's very clear that one might have a fantastic treaty in X or Y region of the world, but if there's not capacity to actually implement that treaty, then it's pretty much a letra muerta, we call it in Spanish. It's just basically that letter, or it's good to collect dust in some shelves. So thinking of the typology that was developed some years ago by Professor Patricia Walters, in which you can actually dissect in a way international water law in scope, substantive rules, procedural rules, etc., we can start populating a table in which we see best practices of elements that allow you to infer ecosystems approaches in this or that treaty. For example, regarding to scope, we heard from Professor Benedictson a good example of how Canada and the US have taken this definition of ecosystems into the treaty of the treaty between the two countries. Also, we have seen from the UNECE best examples of how to do this, specifically in the 1992 Helsinki Convention. And of course, we have for instance, from a functional scope, we have the idea of good ecological status coming from the EU Water Framework Directive. In terms of substantive rules, well, we have heard the minimum standards that one has to take into consideration for protection of ecosystems under the UN Watercourses Convention. We also heard about the UNECE Water Convention, and we were talking yesterday, for instance, as an example, of environmental flows under the Inkomati-Maputo agreement. Similar exercises you can find in procedural rules related to institutions and related to dispute settlement mechanisms. Those are two areas in which I'm having a little bit of struggle. I'm not really sure if the ecosystems approach actually has implications for institutional design. This I'm not very clear. My impression is that it doesn't. And at the level of dispute settlement mechanisms, I am also struggling. My feeling is that there's not so much of an impact, but once again, I would like to have your input if you have something to say related to that. So what is what I'm seeing? I'm seeing that there are examples scattered here and there of what we call best practices, but there's no uniformity around what we considered the ideal mechanism to include ecosystems approaches in water treaties. The implication of this is that there is a lot of work out there related to the benefits of having this ecosystems approach to new treaty regimes, but there's no clear guidance for states on how to go about it. Let us remember the amount of river basins, transboundary river basins that lack some type of legal or institutional arrangement. So this is also where the importance of the research actually comes from. And having said that, within the existing regimes, I've heard several times, I've read several times that our current legal frameworks, they are not fit for conserving and preserving and using in a sustainable way ecosystems. But I believe that that's a very subjective assertion. I have the impression that we need more objective criteria in order to evaluate whether regime X or regime Y, whether the treaty in Lake Tanganyika or whether the Sixaola River Basin Agreement actually are fit or not for protecting and preserving ecosystems. So in a nutshell, my impression is that there are no clear sets of standards, indicators, and criteria in order to make an objective assessment or evaluation of ecosystems vis-a-vis international water law. So this is where this idea of indicator approaches comes into, to have some type of if you want some type of guidance into how to go about this problem. It is inspired pretty much in compliance and effectiveness literature. My supervisor knows that I struggled a lot into getting my head around these topics. We have to recognize that there is a dense and complex amount of literature specifically regarding compliance and effectiveness. It has been dealt extensively, not only by legal scholars, but also by international relations scholars. That's something that has to be taken into consideration. But it's also important to recognize that not so much work has been done around the topic of international water law. The focus has been in general around the international environmental law, looking at specific regimes. For example, there has been a lot of studies related to the Montreal Protocol, related to air pollution. But in the specific field of international water law, it seems that it hasn't been so well researched. So also the idea of governance by information, I think it relates to some of the points that I've made before, having some clarity regarding structures, methods, procedures as a means of guidance for practitioners that are in the task of developing new agreements or assessing their actual agreements. And finally, one of the ideas that Professor Benedictson was mentioning, the idea of accountability and reporting. Against what are you going to report? Against what are you accountable? So the idea of having clear obligations within a treaty regime that allows you to understand whether you are in breach or not, or whether you are implementing or not a specific legal regime. Are we talking about creation of protected areas? Are we talking about legislation related to invasive species, and so on and so forth? So if we don't have clear rules and norms, we cannot have a good accountability and good reporting. So the idea eventually is to create a set of indicators that allows us to evaluate whether a regime is fit or not for the protection, conservation, and sustainable use of ecosystems approaches. There are some examples. By no means I intend that my research is going to be or look exactly like the Human Development Index. That's obviously not the idea, but it's the type of examples in which I am starting to look at to understand how it could eventually be used. Related specifically to environment, we have the good governance indicators from the World Bank, for example, and we also have a very recently launched by the World Resource Institute, the Environmental Democracy Index, which look pretty much at good governance indicators related to transparency, related to corruption, related to that type of issues, but in the broader context of environment. And specifically in the context of transboundary water resources, the GEF had actually a project, thank you very much, in which the University of Dundee was a partner developing the legal components of indicators for evaluating transboundary water basins and their status in a way. So one last point that I missed, what are the benefits of using this indicator-based approach? There are many. I think it touches upon issues of efficiency, consistency, being more transparent, being more objective, based on science, and impartiality, being less subjective. So when one says this or that basin is, or this or that regime is fit or not, you make it based on objective criteria. So how does it look like in the specific context of international water law? So my methodology is that I am starting to mine different indicators within within the existing literature, but also within best practices in different treaties. Then I'm mining those indicators and putting them in a draft matrix, where eventually I'm going to contrast whatever I have mined against the 12 principles of the ecosystems approach to make sure that everything that I have there, it's actually relevant and it's actually speaking to the ecosystems approach. And then finally, I'm going to use that depured table of indicators to test or to make a desk analysis on three different case studies in which I'm going to assess whether they have somehow incorporated in the regime those indicators that I'm actually looking for. Eventually, in order to ground truth these results, the idea is to have an external review in which I would present my preliminary results to stakeholders in the basins that I'm actually looking at, in order for them to give me feedback whether they feel that these results are fair or not, or whether I'm missing some points that because I'm not actually there, it might be that I'm missing this or that, specifically thinking of issues related to capacity and implementation capacity. And hopefully the final product that can be extracted from those case studies can serve to assess or to be used in similar situations in other river basins. So this is different river basins in which the IUCN is working, and the relation to me with the International Union for the Conservation of Nature in relation to the PhD is that I will be able to present my results, and the doors are going to be open in a way to present results in the Sixaola River Basin and in the Lake Titicaca shared between Bolivia and Peru. This is quite important because for me it's very, very important to validate my results. But additionally, there's the expectation to have a third case study, which is going to be hopefully a European case study in which we can actually test how the multi-layer governance looks in the European context. Thinking maybe we're going to work with the Spanish-Portugal case study. So you would have a situation in which you have the UN Watercourses Convention, the UNECE Convention, the Water Framework Directive, and then a specific bilateral agreement between the two countries. So I want to see whether those results are very different or not from what we might find in Latin America. So that's the idea. So examples of how it looks like, I have run on my time, so time is over. This is just an example of how it would look like. So for the problem of regime design, thinking whether the scope of the treaty incorporates ecosystems approaches, or in the implementation capacity a problem that I posed, whether public participation is being taken or not in the specific legal regime. So potential implications, I think we have talked about it. So with that, I would say muchas gracias. Thank you very much.
The focus of your research and proposing this idea of having indicators for transboundary water governance. And so you asked for feedback, and I'm going to ask our audience here to give Juan Carlos some feedback on his ideas. So I see one hand already.
I know that those, I don't know how to correlate. Bhutan has developed a national health index, something like that.
Mm.
So if we try to replicate, they have the set of questionnaires.
Yeah.
Submitted to the article, something like that. So in terms of transboundary bus, we talk about transboundary happiness index, something like that. Then you just get a questionnaire and
feedback and how we see the result. Just a thought you wanted to
thank you. Just a small note, you know that Costa Rica was the number one country for a couple of years, and I think then we lost it to Bhutan.
Juan Carlos, you know that my field is marine law, but I'm thinking about some parallels between my field and your field that might assist you. And in the field of marine fisheries law, at the level of entire ocean basins or parts of ocean basins, there's a type of body called a Regional Fisheries Management Organization, or RFMO. These are interstate organizations that deal with the management of fish stocks at a very large geographical level. And there are in the world perhaps 10 or 15 of those across the Atlantic, Indian, Pacific oceans. And there are some that deal better with the ecosystem approach than others. Some are criticized for really having a pure fisheries focus, and some are celebrated for having a wider focus. Mm-hmm. And I was struck by your box at the beginning where you illustrated that you needed some input on the interaction between the institutional level and the ecosystem approach. Mm-hmm. And I think you might find it interesting to look at the website of the, I'll tell you afterwards, but the Commission on the Conservation of Antarctic Living Resources, which is well known as a regional fisheries management organization that is very much based on an ecosystem approach, in contrast to some of the other RFMOs, which aren't. So that might assist. I'm also thinking, just on the indicators point of view, these RFMOs periodically undergo performance reviews. And I've never looked at one of the performance reviews, but they are, I think, meant to be independent. Mm-hmm. And I'm not sure what criteria, what indicators are adopted for assessment of government performance. But again, we might like to have a look at that, either to see if it's something worth following or whether it's something worth avoiding.
No, fantastic. Also, a part of the research that we are doing builds upon, or has built upon Ramsar related and wetlands related issues, and also a implementation of CBD mm-hmm. and protected areas, but hasn't looked so much at the marine or at the Arctic issues. So I think that's that will be really, really useful.
Thanks. Thank you. Another question from Georgie McKenzie and Robin Stein, who I guess are in South Africa. I'm not sure if it was to you or me, but I think you can help anyway respond here. So the question is about the role and extent of stakeholder consultation in the course of aligning regional shared transboundary watercourse agreements with the Watercourses Convention, I think, maybe there's a more general question there, because that must be a critical, that must be one of the key areas, as you presented, a key indicator is this level of stakeholder consultation, and it still seems to be a big challenge.
Yeah.
So maybe you'd like to...
Well, from the perspective of the regime, thank you, Robin. Thank you very much for your question. It's very, very encouraging to know that you're watching. From the perspective of this research specifically, maybe you can refer to it in a broader sense. That's one of the biggest congruences that I see between the ecosystems approach and current international water law, that the public participation and public engagement is so much of a lip service, if you want. There's so much talk about it. There's so very few examples in which a public participation is taken to the highest level, in which public can actually take part of the decision-making process in the same, almost at the same level as a state representative. Of course, there's different degrees of public participation, being one of the celebrated examples, for instance, the Danube Commission and how they incorporate the public in the activities that are developed at the technical level, for instance. But in my view, I think that higher standard is the one that we should be aiming at. And the part of the messages that I wanted to send out yesterday was that through good legal regime design, this can be actually achieved. So there's nothing that speaks against, including provisions for having representatives of the civil society within this or that treaty. So for me, that has to be the standard. It's not right now the norm, but why not within those river basins that haven't still yet designed an institution or a treaty, why not include this type of articles and provisions? I don't know if you wish to compliment.
I think you said it all.
So the when you say the indicator, are these indicators about the ecosystem per se, or are these indicators about the governance of the treaty? First question. And the second, when you say indicator, there must be a logical framework as well that, okay, before the treaty and after the treaty, and this kind of change will occur, this will be the result, this will be the indicator, and how the quality of indicator will be assessed and how it will be monitored. So is your research going on that level?
Maybe towards the postdoc or potential, because what I am understanding from your question is to have a baseline upon you can actually measure with the indicators issues of effectiveness, right? So I think this is where I started. This is where my original ideas were starting, right? So what could be indicators to measure success of a specific regime, be that in transboundary water law or be that in fisheries or in other fields? But because of different issues related to resource, time, funding, etc., there is no time for me to actually go into the depth of understanding how things have changed before and after a legal regime has been put in place. That's an exercise that takes 10 years, 15 years of research at the minimum. So this escapes the scope of my research. My research would be more, or I would be satisfied to have a set of clear indicators that can be used for those purposes of measuring erosion. That's pretty much it.
But these indicators which you will develop, you will be able to score the effectiveness of treaties and how these have been applied.
Yeah.
So you will be able to compare with one group of rules in a scientific way, and you will be able to score this treaty against that treaty and the application of this treaty in this river basin against this is what you're doing.
Also another idea that that was fleshed out to give some type of evaluation of a proxy to say, okay, this country is implementing, I don't know, let's take norms related to invasive species. This country is doing very, very well. Let's give them a 9. And in the case of the case study, let's take Peru and Bolivia, for example. And you would see if Bolivia is doing much better, let's give them a 10. But that was very artificial. That was seen also as going too much into the detail. And there's also no time within the time frame of the research. So it's more of an exercise of greens and reds, if you want, right? So you would get greens if in the treaty, for example, you have provisions for a related to invasive species, and you get a red if you don't. So then the idea is that at the end, if the whole matrix looks for the Sixaola River Basin very green, for instance, having given a yes or no to all the indicators, then you can use that at least as a base for comparing with a basin that looks all red. So it doesn't give you specific details, but it at least serves as a first step to make these comparisons and evaluations that you're talking about. So that's the idea.
Why you choose these three or two cases? What made you choose that specific three cases for study?
Why?
Yes.
They were selected on a basis of being ecosystem biodiversity rich areas, number one, but also on the basis of what I mentioned of this ground truthing step, which is very important for my, at least for my formation. I don't think you can make a value judgment, or you can suggest something that affects stakeholders, especially talking about public participation, if you don't discuss with stakeholders what you are researching and finding out. So
an important criteria for selecting of the case studies was actually the possibility of going there and having connections to meet with state representatives, but also with civil society as a means of presenting this this research and getting their feedback. And the European case study was pretty much selected because of its relevance in testing this idea of a multi-level governance.
Okay, well, I think we're going to close this this part of this morning's session. Thank you very much, Juan Carlos. I would now like to invite Celine Saglam of the Ministry of Foreign and Water Affairs in Turkey, who's going to present us the legal framework relating to the Merrick River Basin and discuss current and future prospects. And on this note, also, I'll say goodbye to all of you because I have to leave in 15 minutes. But Alistair will take over for the rest of the morning. So, Celine, the floor is yours. Thank you. Thank you very much. I'm Selin Sala. I'm an engineer. I'm working as an expert in the Ministry of Forest and Water Affairs. And as a Jamone scholar, I'm doing a six-month research in this center. Today I'm going to talk about the legal framework of the Merrick River Basin, current practice and the future prospects. In the beginning, I will start with a very brief introduction about the border potential of Turkey, and then focus on the Merrick River Basin, the general description of the basin, the riparian countries, and then the problems experienced in the basin, and then the legal framework of the basin. And at last, I will tell what is the missing points in the agreements and what can be the solutions. If you look at the water potential of Turkey, if we add all of them, we got annual total usable water of 112 billion meter cubes. And if you divide it by the population of Turkey, you got 1,480 meter cubes per person per year. So if we look at the classification of the fall, and we can clearly say that Turkey is a not water-rich country. It is in the classification of the countries experiencing water stress. So management of the waters in Turkey, it's a very, really important issue for Turkey. And in Turkey, there is 25 river basins, and amongst them, five of them are the transboundary river basins. One of them is Kurarak River Basin, one of them is Çoruk River Basin, and Fırat Dicle or Öpros Tigris River Basin, and Asi Orontes River Basin, and today's our topic is the Meriç Evros River Basin, which is in the southeast. The basin is situated in the Balkans, south of Europe, and it calls Meriç in Turkey, Evros in Greece, and Marissa in Bulgaria. There is three riparian countries in the basin. One of them is Bulgaria, which is the upstream country, and Greece and Turkey are the downstream countries in the basin. The drainage area is 50,000 km², and the distribution of the this area to the countries is also given. And water potential of the basin is 8.5 billion meter cube per year. And the contributions of the countries to the water potential of the basin is also given in the slide. Now, if we try to look at the tributaries of the basin, the main river is the Meriç River Basin, which originates from the Bulgaria mountains, and then it flows through Bulgaria for 305 kilometers,
and then forms the Turkey-Bulgaria Turkey-Greece border till it discharges to the Aegean Sea. And then the other tributary is Tunja. It is also originates from Bulgaria, and it flows from through the Bulgaria, and it's joins with the Meriç near the city of Edirne, which is a Turkish city. And the other tributary is Arda, again originates from Bulgaria and flows through the Bulgaria. And the kilometers are given in the slide, and then again it joins to the river at near the Meriç Edirne. You can see that all the tributaries and the main river is joined near Edirne, so it causes a very big water potential in there, and then it causes flows. And the other one is Kızılçay, originates from Greece, and then meets with the Meriç. Total length is like that. And the Ergene is the last major tributary which flows totally in Turkey, and then joins with the Meriç 30 kilometers before they flow into the sea. And also, and here in the when the river is merged into the sea, there is a very important delta at the mouth of the river. The area is like that, and the it's a very ecologically important delta with birds hosting nearly 300 bird species, and it's also under the Ramsar Convention, the Greek part. And now, what are the problems experienced in the basin? The main problem is flows, as you see in the awesome map. They all come to the downstream, and then water pollution and drought. Yeah, there is flows, but also sometimes there is drought because the precipitation can change, and also according to the management of the dams, sometimes drought also experienced in the basin. The reasons of the flows is heavy rainfall, melting of snow cover, reduction of the river bed. Because there is a very sedimentation in the basin, so it causes sandlands in the riverbed, so it makes the whole capacity of the river, decrease the capacity of the river, and the inappropriate management of the Bulgarian dams. The first documented flood is very earlier times, but the milestone is 2050. It is a very destructive flood, and it continues in 2006-2007. Here are some pictures of the floods, and you can see the numbers. It causes $50 million loss to Turkey, and also a lot of irrigation land are flooded. And also these are some pictures from the flood. And also you can see the graph. The three of the four flows experienced in 2005 are the biggest flows experienced in the last 21 years. And also you can see from 2006 to 2012, there are very big flow events and caused a lot of destructions in the basin. Also, I said there's a water pollution. It becomes from those three of the countries, and the type of the pollution differs to the differs to the countries according to the countries. And also the metal pollution is important from Bulgaria, and the others are especially industrial activities, agricultural and unpolluted domestic wastewaters. Mm-hmm. And as I said before, also the basin experienced drought, in 993 drought, Turkey had to buy water from Bulgaria to meet its irrigational water needs. So it's really sometimes so serious. Now, if we try to look at the megaform of the basin, there are lots of treaties. So I want to test them a bit quickly to be not so boring. These are the legal frameworks, and then it continues. Really, there's a lot of agreements. If we look at the bilateral agreements between Turkey and Greece, the main agreement is 1923 Treaty of Lausanne. It defines the border, the Mediterranean border between the Greece and Turkey. And the 1934 agreement is about the construction of the hydraulic facilities on both banks of the Mediterranean River. And it defines the infrastructures that the parties are allowed to also have some procedural and substantive rules like exchange of topographic data, periodic notification for the construction of facilities. And also there is a provision for the dispute settlement. And in 1963, this is also, these are all between Turkey and Greece. And this is about the regulation of the riverbed, protection it from erosion. And it also has some provisions about exchange of information, establishment of joint teams. And for dispute settlement, this agreement established a joint technical commission. This is a more broad convention about cooperation on environmental protection. It also has some provisions about, again, cooperation, exchange of data. This is the joint declaration on environment and climate change. And now the others are usually, as a scope, they take the river or the border, but now it is the scope is the Mediterranean basin. So, and also it's more about, again, flood problems, establishment of flood warning system. In flood warning systems, the relations are very good. And yes, but there is no dispute settlement mechanisms in related to this agreement. If we look at the Turkey-Bulgaria relationship, it starts with the 1968 agreement, which deals with the border incidents and maintenance of the border signs. And it exercised due diligence related to conservation, maintenance, repair, and renewal of the border signs. And also to implement the agreement as an institutional mechanism, it provides the regional commissions. And 1968 agreement is about the utilization of waters flowing in the territories of the two countries. It also has some substantive and procedural rules like avoid causing substantial damage to each other in the construction and use of installations or rivers. And but there is no institutional organization for this agreement, and there is a commission for the settlement of disputes, and the other provisions summary are there. And this is the one that I told you before. Turkey has had to bought water from the upstream country. And lastly, if you look at the Greece-Bulgaria agreements, it is about the utilization of waters used crossing the two countries. And it also has the similar provisions like exchange of the data, not to cause significant harm, and but there is no special body for the implementation of the agreement, and disputes shall be settled through only diplomatic channels. And in this agreement, a permanent commission is established, because in this agreement there was not established, so this this commission is also looks for the implementation of the other agreement. And this agreement is as a scope, it includes the all transboundary rivers between the two countries, not only a marriage. And it promotes the promotion and cooperation in the field of environmental protection. And it also emphasizes the promote the water protection in the spirit of European Union framework directive. And last, there's a joint declaration for cooperation in the field of management. And it's also a constant dialogue and cooperation between all levels of administration of environment and water. It is a bit also complicated. Oh, okay, so conclusions. if we look at the overview of the legal agreements that done between the countries, all of them are, the continuation of the problems in the still we are facing a flood problem. So the continuation of the problem shows that the inaccuracy of the existing agreements. I mean, there is some gap or some missing points in the agreements. So the first one is all agreements related to management rights bilateral. There is no agreement or project that three of the countries are included. And also the flood problem is also related to appropriate operation management of dams in Bulgaria, because it's Bulgaria operates the dams. They use the level of the water at maximum. So when the rain comes, they open their gates, and then the water all comes to the downstream countries. And there is a very good article related to that. It makes some scenarios. I mean, if it is possible to stop the flows with the good management of dams in the Bulgaria. I can also send it later. And if we look at the functional scope, they are the general focused on the issues of flood protection, construction of infrastructures, or general around the cooperation, but there is no issues covered of water quality and the inflow of water quality and the amount of inflow of fresh water that needs to go to Medici Delta to meet the needs. And as substantive and procedural rules, it's all limited to the just exchange of data and information related to flows, but it shows that it is not enough to just to do this things. For example, Turkey has proposed a joint dam project with Bulgaria, which would serve as means of flood protection irrigation uses. The issue is talking with the countries since 1968, but still they are negotiating. And lastly, the most important as to institutional mechanism, there is not permanent institutional, including the three referring countries. And also, institutional mechanism just comes with the agreement. And then every agreement has some mechanisms, or some of them have not mechanisms. So it's caused a bit complication. So a permanent organization that includes the three countries, and inside there should be some technical groups. One of them maybe dealing with flood, one of them is water quality, but this should be permanent and should include three of the countries. And also for the dispute settlement, it's the same. There is no basin-wide mechanism, so it should be concluded maybe an agreement between the repair parties to make a mechanism.
Great.
Thank you. Thank you,
Celine. I think that was a really interesting case, and just the research you've done, kind of bringing together all the agreements, is quite something in itself. Questions? Yeah, one at the back. And then,
My question is there any limitation in achieving multilateral or trilateral agreements or cooperation in that area between Bulgaria, Turkey, and Greece?
Is there what? Sorry, I couldn't hear.
Is there any limitation in that?
Limitation. Limitation means, I mean, the
agreement. Obstacles. Difficulties.
Actually, for example, about the dams. Also Bulgaria, of course, wants to limit the subject of the agreements. just the exchange of information or just building some early warning systems. But also in 1994, the Bulgarian then passes from government to the private sector. So also maybe the private sector wants to have the highest efficiency. So maybe the other things are doesn't mean so much to the sector. So yeah.
Paula, you had a question.
Yes, but so far then there has been any approach between governments between the three governments who try to make a multilateral agreement?
No, there is no much, but by the term there are good also achievements. We establish early warning systems. It is really very useful both countries. It really affects flooding effects in a good way. The systems are so good, but the three of the countries, no, there is no an agreement or any project.
Palestina?
I want to ask if have you ever had between the two of you a joint study, something that you have monography with the both kinds of scenarios where maybe the cumulative effect of these dams would then be analyzed and then maybe serve as basis for you to push for a trilateral agreement? Or has there ever been a joint study reaching a monography with all these scenarios which then
yes,
would analyze?
No, because Bulgaria doesn't want to talk about this part of the issue. The other parts, really, as I said before, there is a very good improvement between the countries, but about the operation of the dams or the other issues, no, it is not subjected to the meetings or agreements. The topic is always limited to the like exchange of information.
So two of the three riparian states are EU member states and one is not. And I'm not familiar with the detail of the EU Water Framework Directive on the obligation to cooperate regarding transboundary river basins, but I suspect that there's something in the directive that requires EU member states that share a river basin with a non-EU member state to seek to cooperate. I'd be very surprised if there wasn't. And so in the interest of getting a trilateral arrangement going, even if it's not treaty-based, it might be worth having a look at the text of the Water Framework Directive and seeing what it requires member states to do in respect of non-member states.
Yeah, you are so right. According to the Water Framework Directive and also Flows Directive, it both of them says that especially the EU countries shall cooperate. But for the EU, non-EU countries, they endeavor to cooperate with non-EU countries.
Yeah.
So, in that framework, it should be like this. It's also a problem. I mean, they should. But, you know, there is not obligation. I mean, they say that should endeavor to cooperate, but there is not a maybe missing of the dispute. There is not an obligation. You cannot, if some country doesn't do that, there is nothing, punishment or something to that country. So it just goes like that. But you are right. It should be the framework. And according to that, the three countries should cooperate.
Yes, we can discuss afterwards.
Okay.
Yeah. And there's experience as well. In the Danube, you have non-EU states and EU states, but they all agreed to implement the Water Framework Directive, basically. A question at the back?
I think this lack of communication and lack of cooperation is a major problem most times when you have, even in Africa, you have this kind of thing. Now, I'd like to find out, how do you get countries come together to sit together and agree on things, on these things? Because basically, when you don't do these things, it causes more division, because of your problems.
I think, of course, every country thinks their benefits. So, as we discussed all the workshops, it is not easy to come to one point. But especially countries have some also obligations.
under necessity water framework directive or the flows directive. But also there is a missing point that there is not punishment to the countries that if they don't do it. So yeah, it's a bit open.
Okay, well, thanks again, Celine. That was excellent. So now let's move on in the program. Now we have Mehdi Piri Demaj. and picking up on many, I mean, I mentioned the Watercourses Convention a bit this morning, and I think sort of picking up on that and discussing the sort of role with the UNECE, sort of very much looking forward to your presentation, and I'll give you I'll pass over control.
Yeah, okay, thank you very much. Hello everyone, and thank you very much, Ali, for a nice introduction, and also for organization of this work seminar. I'm Mehdi Piri Demaj, I'm from Iran, I'm doing PhD at Masrek University. But of course, it's not really my PhD, it's quite relevant, but not the whole issue. First, I need to tell you that the whole day since morning, since the starting, we have discussed about the prevention, in a way, consultation, notification, all are relevant to prevention of transboundary pollution. And I'm not going to discuss something else, but from a different approach. And my approach would be economic analysis of law. So I will discuss, I will consider pollution as a negative externality, and I will approach the point, the problem from this perspective. But inside of the framework of the United Nations Watercourses Convention and also UNECE Water Convention. So first, this point, and the second one, which I would like to tell you now, is that I'm not going to evaluate the effectiveness of this convention on prevention of transboundary water pollution, because it is a very, very big job and it's not my duty. I just would like to discuss with you the design of this convention on, well, preventing water pollution. Moreover, I will tell some case studies, but I'm not going to discuss the state practice. I will not going to discuss the case studies in detail. So this is only the design. So do not expect me to say you that this is effective for prevention of transboundary water pollution or not. I will just make some sort of concern. That's my goal. And moreover, I will use the economic theory of profit maximization. Well, this is not right all times. I need to tell it from the beginning. But, well, economics believes that, well, most of the companies or most of the firms, they are trying to profit, they are trying to maximize their profit. So this is the base that I will have on my presentation. Well, there are several cases of transboundary water pollution. I'm not going to totally discuss, as Ali and other colleagues, they just mentioned, and a colleague from Colombia just told me within a brief about another oil pipeline ruptured in Colombia, and the transboundary pollution went to the Ecuador and Pacific Ocean just last week. So it happens again and again, and it's not finished yet. But there are many cases that you all may know about them. I will just, for more clarification, this is the pot mills case, as you all know about it. And here is the pot mills, here is in Uruguay. And these people are Argentinian people who are protesting the project. So you see that, well, I do not want to discuss the detail of the case. I will discuss it a bit, and you can find it where it's not placed for that. But the project was here, and the Uruguay benefits from the construction of pulp mills for its own economic interest. That's the fact. Here, well, there could be pollution in the river in both sides, because river transfer in the both areas. So it's not to say that the pollution only will go to the Argentina, but it also is in the Uruguay River, which that's a river. So, but the problem is that the Argentinian people or government will be affected by project, but they will not earn anything on the project. On the other side, the Uruguay may affected by the project, but also earn from the project. So there is benefit here, but not here. Keep that trend on your mind. We will back to it. Well, that's the basic of the transboundary pollution. If in a typical case, then if you can, for instance, in a nuclear power plant, if you see at the map of the nuclear power plant in France, you know, France introduced most of its power from the nuclear plant. If you see at the map, I do not have the map here, but all of these power plants are in the border area, not in the middle of the France. Why this is so? Because they want, if anything happens, they will externalize the pollution to other side, not inside. That's the fact. So it is wise, not really wise, but countries do this. They will just try to externalize pollution. They do not want to spend their money to prevent pollution on the other side of the border. This is not their duty. They are not responsible for that. They are not doing that unless they will be obliged to do that. So that's the fact. The point is that the economic basis for transboundary pollution is that polluter externalize harm to other and not internalize the pollution cost. The question that I would like to discuss this with you is that how effective in terms of this question are these two instruments on, well, let's say to producing incentive for the source state countries, the state which start permitting the project or carrying the project to prevent or to internalize the pollution cost and not externalizing to other countries. We have three general points. I will discuss it in detail in these two conventions. The obligation of the source state to prevent transboundary damage is a customary international law obligation in many other, in nearly all of the environmental convention or most of the bilateral or multilateral agreement, you see this, but this is very general one. Of course, this is not an obligation of result, this is an obligation of conduct, but this is very general. In some instruments, we have a procedural arrangement for transboundary consultation for planet measure with transboundary adverse impact. We have two instruments, namely the ESPU convention and the EU directive, which specifically require parties to do transboundary environmental impact assessment. But the rest just some ask for environmental assessment, some ask environmental impact assessment, but we only have two instruments. Well, the international legal regime for prevention of transboundary water, it's very wide. We have a bilateral, multilateral agreement, as our colleague spoke about them today. There are thousands, I don't know how many, but it would be hundreds of them, if not thousands. We have an international law commission, the articles on law of transboundary aquifers, articles on prevention of transboundary health. Even new, not new, but recently there are principles on allocation of loss slightly touch the point. The United Nations Economic Convention for Europe and the protection and use of transboundary water course and the United Nations Convention on the Law of Non-Navigational Use, they specifically deal with the water pollution. This is why I discuss these two at this presentation. The UNECE Water Convention imposed general obligation to prevent transboundary pollution. Each riparian state has a specific obligation to, well, as far as possible, to do a specific measure to prevent transboundary damage. Each riparian state is obliged to consult with other riparian states about the, well, it's the general obligation, not about the prevention of transboundary pollution, but about every aspect of the water, transboundary water, and also there is a very nice clause that I, not clause, but provision that I like it, and it's information on the condition of transboundary water should be made available for the public under the UNECE Water Convention. So it is not a public participation, but all information should be available about the project, about their adverse impact to the public. Well, these are the details. I think I do not have it much time to discuss all the detail, but you can see article 2, the parties shall take all appropriate measures to prevention. Well, it should be ecologically sound aeration or water, and we can discuss all about this clauses, but there are specific duties. As mentioned, the source estate shall use the low and non-based technology, right, the licensing of the wastewater discharge based available technology, environmental impact assessment. This is important to tell you that this environmental impact assessment, it's not transboundary environmental impact assessment. Yes, the source estate has to do environmental impact assessment. Also, it should include the transboundary adverse impact. But this is not transboundary environmental impact assessment as it is like ESPU convention. So this is two different points. Mutual cooperation, exchange of information, consultation. The consultation on the UNECE Water Convention is a general one. It is not sophisticated. It is not very specific measures for the consultation. But as you say, that the parties shall consultate, shall cooperate regarding the issues covered by the convention. There are also some options which they are not mandatory for parties to do so, like the establishing joint program for monitoring pollution parameters and pollutants, joint or coordinated assessment of the condition of transboundary water. And there is also a point on harmonization of the rules for setting up and operation of monitoring program. These all are options which are suggested by the UNECE convention, and they all are relevant to prevention of transboundary water pollution. But these are not obligatory. These are just the possibilities that the parties can make cooperation on. Oh, sorry. Okay. On the other hand, the United Nations Watercourses Convention has the obligation to use the watercourse in an equitable and reasonable manner, as Ali discussed it and our other colleagues, and obligation to prevent transboundary pollution. Of course, there is a much, not much, but this is a slightly different because of the priority of equitable and reasonable manner and prevention of transboundary pollution between the UNECE Convention and Non-Navigational Use Convention, which of course it's important, but we are not going to discuss about that. And moreover, there is the obligation in the United Nations Watercourses Convention with respect to planned measure. And this is something that I call it procedural measures for planned projects. In that respect, each watercourse estate shall utilize international watercourse in an equitable and reasonable manner, taking into account interests of other watercourse. Well, they may enter into a constellation. There is also a general obligation to cooperate. Obligation to prevent, as I told you, it is possible to have an equitable and reasonable harm under the United Nations Watercourse Convention, because they prioritize equitable and reasonable use on prevention of harm. So it is possible, but if it falls under the equitable and reasonable manner, so you can produce harm on that point. Well, these are the general obligations, but there is a very, very sophisticated procedural arrangement, as was discussed previously, about the consultation, transboundary consultation. But this transboundary consultation for a planned measure, it's only between the states, not public. Public are not involved, not at all at this point. Of course, one may say that, okay, in some countries there is a national law which require the states to also make information available or have a public participation. So in that sense, we can say that, okay, it's possible that in some countries we have a public participation, that the convention do not require that, does not require that, and there is no obligation on that. Well, these are all about the consultation. Okay. Well, so there is three general obligation. I will discuss it in either of you can compare it a bit. In UNECE Water Convention, plus the general obligation, parties have to do certain measures, and such as environmental impact assessment, contingency plan. And moreover, we have a very nice point on that, because in UNECE Water Convention, the parties can have a meeting, and on the meeting of the parties, they issue guidelines, and these guidelines can contribute to due diligence, to recognition and to production of the due diligence obligation. For instance, we have a safety guideline and good practice for the pipeline on the water course. So that contributes in a way to show how the state should permit or how the state should act on that respect. On the other side, the convention mainly general the UN United Nations Watercourses Convention on the obligation to prevent and only require best efforts to maintain the project installation and facility. The obligation of conduct as well, but without any precise purpose. On the consultation, the UNECE Water Convention, there is no specific procedural arrangement. Well, the convention not require, but ask for applying the environmental impact assessment, but as I told you, not transboundary one. On the other hand, there is a very detailed procedure, not environmental impact assessment, but it could be transboundary consultation for planned project under the United Nations Watercourses Convention. Access to information and public participation, the UNECE Water Convention requires parties to make information available with respect to water quality measures and flood, but not public participation. There is, but and the UN United Nations Watercourses Convention is silent about public participation. Okay, our argument, I'm running out of time. So, in the United Nations Economic Commission for UN Water Convention, the obligation of the source state is partly effective. I mean, the design, not considering the practice, all of these points in our mind. Because the source state have the obligation of conduct, but the standard, of the due diligence is left to each riparian state. So unless the court or any adjudicial body or any other third party or third commission want to take care of the situation, there could be conflict because of the duties are not clear and it's left to each member state. And the source states are not required to do consultation, transboundary consultation for planning project. Of course, there are the general obligation for consultation, but not specifically for planet projects. And also there is no specific obligation for public participation. In the United Nations Watercourses Convention, well, there is a procedural arrangement, but the lack of public participation in decision making may underestimate the role of the local community. And well, it could happen to countermeasure, for instance, a state A, well, they have a lower level of water quality, a state B do as well. Who will damage? In that case, the people who are living and use the water, they will be affected, they will be polluted. Of course, these are all possible. In the conclusion, I think that, well, none of these instruments can effectively or completely, they are not designed effectively to prevent transboundary water pollution, but they contribute to do so partly. So, and moreover, you may say that, okay, keep busy. It's impossible for many countries, more particularly some developing countries, to do public participation. What do you expect from them? I agree with that it's nearly impossible, but very difficult to do public participation or to do transboundary environmental impact assessment for all of the projects which will affect water quality or water pollution. But the problem is that should be approach that we are going toward that. Otherwise, well, based on the economic theory, it is a still place for the polluters to externalize the pollution cost. So if we want to totally, which of course it's impossible, it's in theory, it's a theoretical model, but if we want to move toward that, we have to try to at least have this kind of thing. And in practice, we have a few cases, which of course it will be next presentation on that. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank
you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank
you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you law, then well, perhaps it's useless for the country. But when there are many waste discharge on the river, there are many other discharge on the river. And for instance, a company, a water planet wants to establish, and you see there is not much difference. You know, in that case, if you see it's on my own point, of course, not based on the international law, but if you see there are too many discharge in the river and it's impossible to do, for instance, to prevent it, well, you have tried to, you have to try to flood control all of them. Otherwise, it's impossible to just by permitting or just by asking a company or a developer to prevent the pollution, clean the river. You need to ask all of them, and it's not an easy job for one or two cases. So that's a different issue, of course. But we're just discussing in a case that, for instance, in the case of the Bachman, you can see that there is too much adverse, not too much, but there is a claim or alleged adverse impacts from the planet, which is quite close to the border. And you can see the transportation of the pollution from the other side of the border. So in that case, it is not so difficult. But yeah, in some cases, for a river 1,000 kilometers, and in 1,000 kilometers, there are too many discharge on the river. So in that case, yes, you are right. But my point is for the cases that the transboundary pollution is quite clear, and you can prevent that.
Sarah?
Yeah, just to pick up on that, I mean, that's obviously another way in which what's going on at national level is linking to international, and you can see the international treaties driving state behaviour, but you can also see the domestic practice speeding up, and the UNECE is a good example of that. All those specific examples of what states should do come from national environmental law. And I think there's another. I mean, we talk a lot about diffuse pollution in terms of agricultural pollution and small-scale farmers, and we know that we come down to individual level and it's probably harder to control. But we can also think about small-scale operators, small-scale, more diffuse activities, and around wastewater management and human settlements. And I wonder if the drive to around water efficiency and water reuse and beginning to develop standards for wastewater reuse, and I think we're going to see a huge amount of interest in that over the next 10-20 years if we're lucky, both in the developed and the developing world, so different drivers but the same outcomes. And I think that might be a way in, and it's a way in that makes more sense to the economists. So it's easier to kind of price and value. And then perhaps we'll start to see more interest at domestic level in trying to tackle those small-scale, more diffuse impacts on water quality from that other perspective.
Sorry, maybe I'm wrong. I should be wrong. But when you go through the UAE, you are presenting that the pollution issues has not been properly addressed in these two conventions, I'm afraid, because when you read the articles, even in the UNEC convention, it's clearly written that the parties shall take care of all transboundary impacts. It means when you define the transboundary impacts, it takes care of pollution, etc. And also in the UN convention, either individual or jointly, there is scope of taking care of thermal pollution. And as regards to Mr. Nehaus's position on the pollution by other, is there a biennial plan, measures or more, doesn't matter. If there is pollution in international ports, water ports, I think the parties either there, because if you look after the look at the UN basic charter, which does that one, because of any action by one nation, cannot affect other nations. So from that perspective, if any pollution or any adverse impact it happens to any transboundary like real countries, can be taken up in that perspective.
Thank you. I was going to ask a similar question, so you allowed me not to abuse my powers as chair.
So if I understood you correctly, you mean that the source effect will be also polluted and with the pollution, yes? Do you mean that? Or?
No, I'm saying that you are presenting that these two conventions are very limited way addressing the issue of pollution.
Okay.
But it's not so. To me, it looked like that. It is quite elaborate. They're elaborately addressing issues.
Yeah, well, Of course, that's right, but it depends to how do you look at the convention. You can look at comparing to the, for instance, the ESPO convention.
I look at that very positively.
Yeah. We all have to look at it positively. But the problem is that when if you want to prevent the pollution, I mean, I mentioned that we need to take care of all of the possibilities. When based on the economic analysis, if there is position, if there is a place to externalize the pollution, that will happen. So, well, you see, if you see that, okay, there are obligations for the state to consult with other states about, or there are obligations to prevent transboundary damage. I will start with this point that you mentioned. But you know, of course, better than me that there are only a few cases of the compensation of transboundary pollution. There are only a few cases. There are not much cases on that because the compensation, in any case, is much more problematic than prevention. And the state knows that. And in many cases, it is impossible to find the pollution, in particular in the case of the water pollution, because there are many other pollutants are involved in the case. So, yes, the state have an obligation to prevent. But, for instance, you see in the Poppins case, after all the court rejects the Argentina claim that, okay, you did not submit any real pollution to us. Okay, you allege that there is a pollution, but where is the pollution? And they reject the claim of the Argentina, or also in the case of the Slovenia against Slovenia Hungary, there is also that was the claim of the pollution. There is no real pollution. Not real pollution, but it's very difficult. This is why we try to keep it very strong and tough on prevention, because on compensation, there is not too many options for the countries to receive, because political things will come through the compensation, and the ways for compensation become too limited. Well, that's the thing that I can say, but of course, both of the convention have a very good obligation for the parties. It is not fair to say that there is no obligation to prevent, but it is fair to say that obligation to prevent harm is a customary international law. Whether it be included in this convention, whether or not, the state have obligation to prevent. And this is the obligation of the conduct. So nothing, and also obligation of cooperation, whether it could be in both of this convention, whether or not, it is customary international law. So there is not much difference on these two points, but this is the point which is quite important is the procedural arrangement for transboundary consultation, because otherwise they all are in international law. Why do you need this convention then when there is no specific duty for the states?
So, Mahdi, you were noting that the two global treaties, the UNECE treaty and the 1997 treaty, don't include express provision on transboundary EIA.
Yeah.
And in those circumstances, especially because of the dates when those treaties were adopted, one could look to see if customary international law developed or identified since then fills that gap. Now, there are some people here who know the judgment in the pulp mills case off by heart, and I'm not one of those. But is it your view that what the court in Pulp Mill said about EIA can fill the gap that's left by the 97 or the UNECE treaty?
Well, this is also a matter of dispute that some people believe that, well, the wording of the decision of the ICJ is that it's part of customary international law, the environmental impact assessment, and some people not. It is, of course, the matter of discussion still, but the point that I think is that even if we accept that the court upheld conducting environmental impact assessment for transboundary adverse impact of the project, it is still something different with transboundary environmental impact assessment. Well, in that case, the source state will conduct the environmental impact assessment, including what will happen as a transboundary adverse impact. This means transboundary environmental impact. This means environmental impact assessment with for the adverse for transboundary adverse impact. But if we go for a transboundary environmental impact assessment, like an ESPU convention, like an EU directive, we need to have a the source state or the developer shall prepare the environmental assessment, send it to the affected state. Public participation will happen to the in the affected state as well as the source state. They all will comment on the project, what would be the side effect, what would be. Of course, the source state is not obligated to well incorporate all of the comments, but they oblige to take into consideration all of the comments. And there is a possibility for the state to go into a dispute settlement or also the monitoring commission whether the comments have been incorporated or not.
And if Pope Mills said something about transboundary EIA, do you think it said something about your first type of transboundary EIA or something about your second type?
It is about the first time, because not about the second. The second one is only in the ESPU convention and the EU directive. But the first one, now some people believe it's part of customary international law. For now, so for the project, the source state is obliged to conduct environmental impact assessment with transboundary adverse impact, but not transboundary environmental impact assessment.
Thank you.
Okay.
I think one last question before lunch.
It's not a question. Thank you very much for your presentation. I was just thinking, you know, if it ultimately boils down to money, you know, whether you get some wise or expert ones, UNECE is not global as far as I see that.
Yeah.
It's a rich man's club, because if you were in Zambia and you agree to pay all this compensation, you bankrupt yourself and you could continue to develop your economy. So, you know, kind of post-industrial economies like this one, that's right. We made all of the mess as we play it afterwards. But I think there's a very valid point in that, in what you said, between do we prevent or do we compensate? And I think the case of Tisa River, Romania, where there was tailings dams built by an Australian company which were checked under local legislation for their safety. So the Romanian standards were applied, the tailings dams passed. The dams failed and an awful lot of cyanide was released into the Danube. Within a few days' time, the EU Environment Commission was on an aeroplane went there and basically said, we're not going to litigate over this because there's so much infrastructure which is about to collapse in Romania. As soon as we do one, we'll have so much going on. Let us instead focus on going back to what you said, which is on the preventive end. And there's something deeply important about that.
Yeah. Well, that's also a case, but there are also many cases that, well, then there is a transboundary aspect for the compensation. In many cases, the litigation, they are not successful. There are many cases, and there are only few cases the litigation were successful. It includes both of the, I mean, not only about water pollution, but also about other type of the transboundary damage, because there are many other variables which are involved, and it become very difficult for the claimant to receive the compensation. So this is, and the states are not eager to do so. If you see most of the environmental agreements or conventions, they do not. They just focus on prevention rather than compensation, because they know that the parties who are involved in drafting this instrument, they know that compensation is not a good solution. So the prevention, something that can be reached, I mean, partly is good, but compensation, there are many cases which were not successful.
Okay, well, I think we have to leave it there. Thank you. Well, that concludes this morning's session. Thank you very much to our speakers. Thank you for keeping to time. And we thank you for all the questions and the participation from the audience. And we reconvene after lunch.
Yeah, thank you.
I'm not going to admit, I'm going to admit.